Welcome back, everybody, to the Archon Team League Championships. I'm joined by Noxious, and upcoming we have Team Nilum versus Team Celestial. Join with us, we have special guest caster Brian Kaler from Team Value Town, also from BMK Gaming. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Thank you. Awesome. That's right. So how you doing, Brian? You've had a pretty busy week so far, but you've also done excellently thus far in ATLC, so you must be feeling pretty good.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it is a team format, so, you know, unfortunately, we weren't able to quite pull it out yesterday, but, you know, I'm feeling good about our chances moving forward.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, I think you and Sho are the only undefeated people in the league. Can you go undefeated for the longest? Can you outlast Sho?
I mean, I can certainly try. You know, he is a tough competitor himself, has a good team behind him as well. So, you know, that could be a tight race.
Gotcha. And what do you think about these two teams that we have coming up here? I think both of them are really strong teams overall. But what are some of the early impressions you got from Celestial? Because the West knows a lot about Life Coach Tyson RDU, but not too much about these Eastern players.
Well, I've been particularly impressed by Tiddler, his second place finish at the World Championships and his victory at the DreamHack Grand Prix are both accomplishments that really stood out to me, in particular because he had to fight through really big fields to get to the top of both of them. You know, a lot of players have a lot of success in, you know, some of the smaller invitational level events, but Tiddler has really shown that he's capable of having that kind of performance when he has to really run through a gauntlet of a lot of highly skilled players. And that's the sort of results that really stand out as especially impressive to me.
Yeah, in China, they have such crazy open tournaments. I mean, you think DreamHack or, like, you know, 128 players. And I know, Kibler, you've also had your fair share of big tournaments too. But, I mean, China has this, like, incredible amount of open players. Like, 5,000 people show up. And Tiddler's even been able to do well. But he also has a reputation of falling out of tournaments very early in China, but winning in the West. This is something that I was told by Eloise, because she's also a fellow Chinese resident. And she said that Tiddler is unfortunately kind of like the all or nothing player. He either does really, really well, or he bombs out really quickly in the first couple of rounds.
I mean, frankly, with how top heavy, you know, the both sort of BlizzCon point payouts and the prizes in some events can be, I would rather, you know, be someone who swings for the fences and either gets a home run or strikes out.
Sure. By the way, Noxious is still here. I feel like me.
Yeah,
I've been talking for a while.
All right, man. I'm listening to you talk, and it's really enjoyable.
60 minutes with Kibler. I'm sorry.
Go ahead, man. You can take them all.
I talk a lot. What can I say?
Yeah, that's all right. I don't really mind it. But yeah, like, it's really been to go back to Tiddler a little bit. It's been really impressive to see him perform in the West so well. I didn't know that his results in the Eastern parts of Hearthstone community were a little less impressive. I know that WCA he took pretty handsomely, but then again, would that be considered an Eastern tournament or more of a Western one because so many foreigners were invited?
It's hard to say. I think most of them considered the format to also be a joke. I mean, the Chinese Hearthstone scene also really looks at competitive Hearthstone the same lens as we do. They really hate high variance, low amount of games per series. You know, the Gold Series is known as their most prestigious league, but yet the qualifiers and the entire process through to the top 16 is best of three, and they all hate that. So, you know, it's one of those things where that's probably partially why Tiddler can lose easily in those early rounds. But the rest of his teammates, there's something to be said too. He's not the only member on the team. Frozen Ice is known sort of like what Hyped was last year. He was dominating the ladder so aggressively with Miracle Rogue, and he was a primary innovator for the Asian region in Taiwan specifically, and he's a very strong player, but he hasn't been able to put up the results yet in a competitive setting when, you know, tournament or prize money is on the line. And on the flip side, Silent Storm's also been doing really well in tournaments recently too. So I'm actually really excited to see Celestial pick it up this week. I think that they come in here maybe even over the favorite of Nilum. Sorry, I'm going to take a while to get used to that.
Yeah, that's all right. It's just, I feel like if their lineups are good, I know that Tiller had a lot of Warlock experience. I haven't seen him play too much of, you know, anything else. I think that's the decks that I've seen him play the most. And he seems very comfortable with the class overall. Like, any archetype that you seem to throw his way with the class, he's just playing very well. But last week he was playing Warrior and Druid, and he didn't do, like, you know, as well as I expected him to initially. He said, and it was like the coach, the carry of his team, I guess you could say. And it didn't quite pan out that way.
All right, cool. Well, I think we're ready for our second match here in week two, day two. But before we do that, we have a video with Crip to preview upcoming matches and the entire league.
Hey guys, I'm Crip. I stream, I do YouTube content, I like to push out ideas on Reddit, on Twitter, and all the crazy stuff that happens in the game is really what fascinates me, and I try to give that craziness back with the content that I make. I do a lot of casting, I do a lot of playing Arena, most of the funsy modes, and yeah, I enjoy the fun in Hearthstone. The secret to being a good caster, well, there's many different type of casters, and I think each different type, like there's many great casters as far as people see them at least, and I think I'm kind of like a hybrid funny, because I'm not really funny, just like a little bit by accident most of the time, and then there's the analytical caster, which I'm not exactly that either, so I'm the in-betweener. I'm kind of funny and kind of analytical, and maybe that fits a good enough spot, so people like me. Starting a career in esports, well, you definitely need one very distinctive feature to stand out, because as it so happens, most people like playing video games, and they do that a lot. So you're competing with everyone, basically. So you have to be amazingly funny, you have to have maybe good presentation communication skills, or maybe you could just be ridiculously good at the game, and then you don't need anything else, really. Sometimes people do pretty well creating very polished content, so if you're really not too good at anything, maybe consider going to school for like video editing and production, that kind of stuff, and maybe you can push your own content, and the quality of the content makes you stand out from everyone else. So the format is pretty amazing here in Archon's tournament. With players working together, I don't really know what kind of strategy they'll have with the decks because there's so many decks, but one thing that I think we can quite safely predict is the ability of the players to communicate ideas amongst each other. So some of the teams I think are a little bit at a disadvantage, like Forsen Boys, even though some of these guys, you know, they're amazing player by themselves, their ability to communicate together is like a random factor, where we know in some teams, especially the ones that are complete, let's say, already have this attribute to them. So I expect them to have a more consistent team strategy than the, let's call them makeshift teams. So, I mean, that's not really an advantage you can, balance out in this type of tournament, but I will be really happy to see some of the underdogs win. Well, I hope you little Crip dudes that like watching the Crip are going to go check out Crip Cass's tournament, because it should be pretty cool. It's a cool format, and I really like the tournaments that have the cool format plus the competitive aspect. And with a lot of money on the line, the competitive aspect is really going to crush the fun aspect. But we'll see. We'll see. I like the wild stuff, and this is the wild stuff, so hope it's going to be a good show, and you guys enjoy watching me cast it. Tune in to the Archon Team League Championships.
Thank you so much, Griff, for stopping by, and I hope you guys have been enjoying this commentary. And for anybody of those who are coming in just after the break, because we did have a pretty intense series between Cloud9 and Team Liquid, Brian Kibler is joined with me and Noxious as we get ready for Nilum versus Team Celestial. So Noxious, I'll throw it to you first. Like in the lineups here, seems like we have an exact mirror in terms of the actual classes themselves, but maybe not the deck lists.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised we're not seeing any mages on either side. That's something I would have expected at least one team to pick up. Maybe RDU. Like, he's a very comfortable and proficient mage player. That's a class I would have pinned him on, maybe more so than maybe right. Giving. Then again, Tyson's a Druid is a good call.
How about you, Kibler? Does anything jump out to you at all, whether it's characteristics of players in their usual classes or the lineups themselves?
I will agree that it's a little surprising not to see Mage in either lineup. We've seen Freeze Mage in many teams' lineups, and you know, we've felt that it's one of the stronger decks, particularly against a lot of the aggressive decks that are out there. So that's a little surprising. I think we did see it from these teams last week, if I recall correctly.
Yes.
And the more surprising thing is that both teams also brought Paladin, which is one class that we've seen have a little bit of an underperformance so far in the league.
Is it really as big of a liability as people are saying it, though? I know it's very anecdotal at this point. It's like, well, I've seen it fail. It must be bad. Is it even really that bad? I don't even think so.
I think people overstate Paladin's bad matchups in a lot of cases. It is very poor against specifically Patron, because Patron Warrior can punish you for even pressing your hero power button.
Right.
And when you're playing a deck that focuses on generating late game board advantages, that's dangerous when you're playing as a deck that thrives on killing people who have big late game boards. A lot of the other matchups that people say it's weak in, I don't think are nearly as bad as people generally say.
Okay, fair enough. We're going to kick things off with Warlock versus Hunter. Life Coach going ahead with the initial throw here on Nihilum. He's going to open up on Warlock, which people have kind of said that it's not really Warlock for Life Coach, it's just guaranteed Handlock. And I
yeah,
that's a fair assessment. I have never seen Life Coach not play Handlock when he's chosen the Warlock class.
Yeah, he actually, in a recent league that I remember watching him in, that I was also in, he was actually playing Handlock basically every single week, but every week he played a slightly different version of Handlock. Mm-hmm. Like, one week he would have Giants, one week he wouldn't, one week he'd have Void Callers, one week he wouldn't. And yeah. One of the advantages of that is that you make it so that even if your opponent can guess that you're playing Handlock, they can't necessarily pin you down to a very specific list, and that can matter quite a bit in terms of how they play against you.
Yeah, I remember that. I was the Kinguin League, if I recall. Like, I casted him, and every single time we knew it was Handlock, but it was never the same. And, like, a list with Handlock that doesn't have Giants pulls out some demon stuff that you would never expect. So it's really nice to see that. But he hasn't really been innovating too much or iterating too much on Handlock recently. Like, he seems to be sticking to much more standard lists after the, you know, initial hype of GVG.
I believe, if I recall correctly, I believe last week he actually played a kind of interesting list that had Void Callers in it, but only had Mal'Ganis, I believe, as the other demons.
That's definitely something Life Coach would do. Like, doubt about that. Yeah.
I mean, when you see a Void Caller, you know, you're not necessarily thinking, okay, this is Handlock. You're like, okay, maybe this is Demon Lock, and I can attack him down, and then suddenly, Molten Giant, and that could be a problem.
Mm. All right, well, he sees a Worgen Infiltrator, which heavily implies that this would be the more aggressive face hunter. Not really mid-range hunters run this type of card, because you want to get that damage with the stealth minion, otherwise you'd vest in something else. But that still means that Life Coach is, you know, going to be taking it really aggressive. That Ancient Watcher, without knowing the hands, it could mean that he has Sunfear Protector. It could mean he has nothing, too, hypothetically speaking.
Yeah. I mean, the term on Ancient Watcher usually indicates that you have either Sun Fury or Owl here. Mm-hmm. And I mean, frankly, either one of them is pretty strong here. Getting the Owl down to facilitate that being able to take out some of your opponent's board is somewhere that you want it. Yeah, there's the Sun Fury.
Yeah.
It's a little weaker, though, than I feel like the RMB Cal might have been a bit more proactive about the way to do this. Then again, the 2-3 is going to be taking out like two of the smaller minions. Like, I thought initially this could be more of a hybrid list, but it's obviously just going to be full face. Because I haven't seen much hybrid going with Worgen Infiltrator, right? I don't think I've seen any of it, in fact.
Yeah, Worgen Infiltrator is generally indicative of a deck that just wants to be guaranteed to connect with that minion once.
Right.
Well, you want some Life Coach truth bombs here, according to how he plays Handlock? He says you never, ever silence your Ancient Watcher with your Iron Beak Owl. He says it's just wrong. And I was like, what? He says the only time you ever do is if you know you have lethal.
Wow. I've never heard that.
Well, he does run one Owl only most of the time, right? So, I mean, he's valuing those very, very preciously.
Sure. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Could be the reason why he's running one Owl.
A juggle? That could be a big juggle right here.
Oh.
Does not take out the Sunfury Protector. So here, in Frozen Ice, he can either choose to go face with the bow or clear the minion. And it's interesting because, you know, we're going into turn four where Life Coach could possibly play. I mean, he could theoretically play Defender Vargas, not a particularly good defend here. But if he does attack his face, then he's putting him in Molten Giant Rage right away. And I know from talking to Life Coach that he never mulligans a Molten Giant basically against any deck, and certainly not against Hunter. So this is a scary position for Frozen Ice if he just wants to go face. I think he's going to attack the minion, and that's what we see.
Now, Life Coach has got a lot of absolute rules in his way he plays Handlock for sure.
Yeah.
That's what makes it partially really cool too, because I know Live Coach is one of the guys who really pushes the edge of like how long you can tap and what some of the cool stuff it is.
How long you take for a turn.
Yeah, he does.
Which is the edge of everything.
Turns out it's 89 seconds.
Actually, it's 70 now, right? Like since they lowered 69, it. It's 69 seconds. That's kind of oh man, the epic number.
And now, I mean, Frozen Ice is in a position where, you know, Life Coach is pretty low, but he doesn't have quite enough burst to actually finish him next turn.
Yeah.
You know, his Hero Power Pulse Kill Command can only put Life Coach at 5, and now Life Coach is in range for free Giants and is at mana to actually cast Healbot.
Yeah, that's what you're most worried about here is, like, Molten Giant Healbot is a disaster. Even just one Molten. Yeah. Molten's enough.
I mean, I imagine this is probably an explosive trap, given that that he's playing Face Hunter. Usually you don't see freezing there. If it was freezing, though, he'd basically be committed, and there it is, explosive trap. He basically committed to killing that that Healbot.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's you know, doesn't quite have enough damage to actually really put Life Coach in range of finishing him off anytime soon, and he's facing down 2-turn lethal.
So I guess you're just pushing for damage and hoping for quick shot. I mean, there's no way you can actually really deal with that giant effectively. You could put it down like 2 health if you, I guess, skill command it, but...
There's no way that he wins this game if he uses all of his resources on putting giant on 2 health here.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's just, that's Argus just not going to happen. Right.
What is nice, though, is that you can kind of move past that the Molten Giants already existed out there, so... You can just go ahead and go all phase two before he inevitably gets a taunter out. Because clearly he wanted to play this this antique heal bot so he can bounce back up to 18 health. But it also means that if he has a taunter, you need to get the damage in with the hounds now. So I really like going for the face here and not necessarily like hedging to try to put the antique heal bot at 2 HP, for example.
Yeah, and quick shot is also like one of the... You're still hoping for quick shot. There's a few cards that could make this work. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, if Life Coach doesn't do something to kill those minions, yeah, like just a kill command wins because he has the 2. Oh god!
No. Oh well.
Well,
kill command wins. Oh wait!
Oh, that's game. Yeah, can't do anything about that. He took the gamble and ends up paying the big price here.
Yeah, that's kind of the strength and the weakness of Hunter is, you know, half the time the Warlock will whiff on answers, but when he does get them, then there's no hope of you really getting back in.
Well, yeah, it's just laughably one-sided if Hanlock can handle the aggro. That's why it's so funny that for a while Hunter was considered as the counter to Hanlock, and then when Healbots came out in GVG, Hanlocks then were starting to perceive as maybe even favored against Hunter overall if you know how to mulligan correctly, and chances are you end up getting the right hand. In that case, Life Coach came out to a very, very quick win.
Like, what are the chances of getting a Molten Giant from a Warlock perspective? If you're, let's say, on the coin with 4 cards, you mulligan everything, you're like 9 total, it's like, what, 55-ish? Like, upwards of, like, 50%
plus?
Yeah, you
open up the game around 40, a little bit under 45%, like, being able to draw, and every single draw increases it by a little bit more, I think.
All right.
That is how math works.
Yes, it is.
Whoa, it increases.
Why pass?
You have a better chance of getting one.
Draw more. You'll get more cards.
All right, well, now it's gotten to the point where you can pretty much just still throw out anything here, but you know, it's kind of painful that Hanlock got to squeeze away here, because I feel like there's a lot of good decks nowadays that can still handle Hanlock really well. Like Frozen Ice as a rogue specialist, I think he would have been happy to face that. Druid against Hanlock's also been favoring the Druid a little bit, even the slower Paladin too. So I think this was definitely not an ideal way to start for Celestial.
That makes you're right.
It's interesting. Like I actually have found that I have more success against Hanlock with more like hybrid or mid-range type hunter decks than with strict face hunter, just because those decks have more tools to actually fight through and have repeated damage sources if your opponent does get something like a healbot. In a lot of cases, face hunter will just lose if they play a healbot, period. You know, and certainly lose if they play 2. But if you have things like Piloted Shredder or Savannah High Main that could potentially be these repeat damage sources, you can actually manage to burn through that extra health.
Yeah, I think the best way that I was explained was that Face Hunter has very linear damage, and then Mid-Range Hunter has, I guess, exponential, not really exponential damage, but it ramps up really quickly. Yeah. It's a curve. parabolic, whatever you want to call it. I don't care.
Parabolic goes up and then it goes down.
The idea is that you can
lose. This is just a math cast now. We're just talking about math left and right.
That's right. You can loom over your handlock player for a while, right? And then you just play things that you know will do big damage, like Houndmasters and Lothebs and High Mains, but you don't have to press in just yet, and all of a sudden it's an 18 damage kill the next turn.
Yeah. being able to play around Molten Giants is something that that mid-range style Hunter decks are capable of doing, while the face Hunter decks, basically, they just have to throw their damage right at their opponent's face. Are you guys just trying to copy my expression now? That's happening, right?
Yeah. I can't do it, man. Look,
a good casting team has to have synergy. And,
yeah, exactly.
You know, it's like impersonation is the highest form of
play. Faceless Manipulator, engage. Gotta work on that faceless impression. All right, so, like, onwards to the Warlock that Life Coach secured. I feel like, as you said, you know, so many decks can handle it now that getting it out of the way so early is really good. And the fact that they've got information about the fact that it's a face hunter really gives them a lot of, just that information alone is priceless. And that's probably why they went with, you know, face hunter first, because if it steals a game, then they can't really play that against you. They can't really use that information against you. But from now on, I mean, Nihilim is fully equipped.
Yeah, that's one of the interesting things about the team format is the information that you actually gain from watching each of the decks in action. And the fact that, you know, your teammates can be watching the cast and actually getting information, even of cards that aren't played, is very relevant. You know, like, you know, it's like, okay, he's playing this deck. Oh, he has a Harrison Jones. He didn't play it, but now we know that he has this Harrison Jones for future matchups. And that's one of the things about the team dynamic that I think is actually really cool.
Nice. How is Value Town as a team? You know, you guys are more of a loose connection compared to some of the other tighter teams that might be out there, like Celestial, who all speak Chinese together and they all like really plan. And even Crit was saying in the video that he wasn't predicting the free agent teams to do that well, but it seems like you guys have it together so far.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've definitely worked pretty well together. None of us were particularly close before this. I mean, you know, both Trump and Dog are players who I respect and whose streams I've tuned into many times, you know, long before we had this sort of Value Town association. But I mean, we've all worked together really well. One of the things that has worked especially well for us is that we actually all have particular strengths that we're able to lean on. Like Dog, for instance, you know, plays more Rogue than maybe anyone in the world. Whereas, you know, I have 2 ranked games of Rogue or whatever under my belt. I'm actually not even joking. I think that I literally have 2 ranked wins as Rogue on my account.
Freeze Mage as well, right? I think Rogue plays a lot more Freeze Mage than you do.
That's true, yeah. Dog plays Freeze Mage and Rogue, which we saw not this week, but the week before. And then Trump, you know, has probably Life Tapped more than anyone in the world, except maybe Life Coach. Well, he probably has done it more than Life Coach just because he does it way faster than he does.
Yeah,
the lifetap per hour count is higher.
He uses his rope, you know, pretty intense.
Taps per hour are higher. For sure.
Exactly, yeah. Taps per hour. Yeah, that's a stat we should track.
Yeah,
and Trump also plays quite a bit of Warrior. You know, he's pretty experienced patron control Warrior. Played both of those quite a bit, and those are decks that I haven't really, you know, played all that much myself. I focus more on playing.
No.
Have we lost Kibler?
I want to know what he focused on.
You know, sort of mid-range aggressive styles of decks. We've all been able to play to our strengths in this format so far.
Gotcha. Oh, well, I think we're right now just waiting for our next player to set up. But I think that's really cool insight specifically because people weren't sure about how Value Town would do. But it seems like you guys definitely are keeping it together. And I think that's part of the excitement too because in a lot of ways, the free agents, they don't expect them to work together, so they're like, and you know, they're not exactly favoring them compared to traditional units. Like, you know, Nihilim has Life Coach, Tyson, RDU. That's like a really strong, cohesive unit. So it might even be more motivation for like Force and Boys, etc., to do better too.
Yeah, I mean, Force and Boys are doing super well, right? Like they've won 2 weeks in a row. So
that's right.
Sadly, 2 weeks in a row. The first one, fine, they can have that. But
it's sure. Really, really close. Really, really close there. That's right. I guess just checking in. I think we're just having setting up the next player here. I really like being able to toss out another player too and mixing it up. I don't really like getting the bench early, even though I know it truly doesn't matter in the big picture mm-hmm. of things. I still would not be in favor of like sending Frozen Ice here. I think it's okay to have Silent Storm or Tiddler throughout a feeler deck here.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely some considerations as far as benching is concerned. Early on, I think it matters less because there's still a lot of options from your other teammates. But later on, there is a serious penalty if one of your players gets benched and the opponents have full information about what they can expect to play against.
Yep. Makes sense. Well, okay, looks like we're ready to go. Tiddler is going to be on Warrior, life coach on Warrior as well. Expect patron versus patron.
Control would have the edge on this front, though. Actually, the game's been going on a little bit here. It seems like there was a lot of armor pass, so either one of them is playing control or both patron with somewhat slowish ends. All right.
It seems we're actually jumping into the game. Looks like it's like turn three here.
Yeah.
Yeah, one person used shield block. I think it's Tiddler. It makes sense considering that he likes putting a shield block and one armor smith and using that split so that way he takes that, you know, hybrid approach. Especially because sometimes you need a little bit of cycle through to the patron that people have been really saying recently. So I think it's okay. It worked for him in DreamHack, certainly.
They're going to restart the game, it seems. All right, we're going to restart the game entirely based on the information we got. We missed a big portion of the game, so they really want to make sure we get everything. So they'll probably pick the same class, Warrior versus Warrior. No information was given away, aside maybe from the shield block, which I don't think is necessarily too meaningful.
Yeah, actually, it's ambiguous enough that might make Life Coach reconsider what it is.
Yeah. Actually, yeah, that might make him think that's Control Warrior, in which case, oh my god.
But you can deduce that it's not Face Warrior.
Yeah, I mean, everybody knows Face Warrior. I mean, the double
play shield block in Face Warrior. You can't shield slam the face.
Oh man, Death Wish. Remember that card? You ever played around with it? No, maybe you don't know it.
Death Wish?
Consume all your armor. Your hero gains +1 attack for each armor.
Oh god.
You never played around with that? That was in the beta. I played in the Hearthstone Alpha / beta. They had that card.
You lose all your armor, but it turns into attack.
Yeah, Armorsmith was a 2/3 though, so it was like it was harder to get armor because it wouldn't last as long, so your AoE wasn't relevant, but you would one-shot people easily.
Can Savagery hit the face?
No, it used to be you know what it used to be, right? Like the two mana
AoE,
like you would just stick your attack and deal that much. Like it was a Blade Flurry.
Yeah, actually that's the crazy thing. Savage Roar was Blade Flurry for Druid. Yeah,
and Bite was 6 attack instead of 4 attack for armor. So you would bite and then Blade Flurry for 6 to everything and then attack face with the remaining 6 because it didn't destroy your weapon. Yep.
The inner game designer for Kibler is knocking inside a little bit.
It's like, oh my god, how could they do that? But they fixed it. So and it took a while. Initially, we were really afraid that Hearthstone would launch with those cards, but Blizzard caught onto all those.
I mean, that's just sort of part of the process of
TCG
set design and development is you don't want to have cards that are all just safe. You know, when you have a set that's full of cards that no one is worried might be a problem, then you just have cards that, you know, no one is particularly excited about playing with. So when there's cards that sort of jump out to people, it's like, oh my god, what can you do with this? You know, things like Emperor Tharizin. You know, yeah. Emperor Tharizin is a card that when it first came out, people were like, oh my god, this is the craziest card ever. And now, you know, however many months later, people still think it's pretty much the craziest card ever. But yeah. It's not necessarily completely broken. It's just something that enables all of these really cool things that wouldn't be possible otherwise.
Yeah, yeah, I was really hoping for Nefarian to also continue to take off. Or just in general, dragons, but...
I think Nefarian's actually my favorite card, like, from Blackrock Mountain.
Yeah,
I think that not only is it, you know, an awesome gigantic dragon, but it also creates all sorts of cool moments that, you know, you wouldn't otherwise see in a typical game of Hearthstone. The number of Jiraxes I have sacrificial packed when I'm playing various dragon decks is actually remarkable. Particular, when you keep duplicating your Nefarians, eventually you find Sacrificial Pact.
Yeah, that's good. That's pretty smart.
Pretty cool, yeah. I mean, I'm kind of liking this. I like how this is going. The deck creation of Hearthstone by Kibler. Basically, everybody puts a Nefarian, so no game will ever be the same.
Okay, that's you know, from a sort of game design perspective, Hearthstone games, I actually think it's important that there are a lot of these random elements because so much of the game is actually static from game to game. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that each player has the same hero power, each player can mulligan and frequently have a very similar opening hand, each player right. gets the same resources on the same turns. You know, you need to have elements of randomness in order to break that up so the game doesn't play out super similarly from game to game.
Yeah, I mean, ooh. It makes a lot of sense, I think.
It's very insightful, Kibler. Be careful, man.
It's almost like I might have worked in game design at some point in my life.
What is game design? How do you make a game? Okay, so you just smash all these pieces together. Like, when you're a kid and you design your first game, like, if you actually like making games, the game you make is so off. It only takes, like, once you go, you look back on it, when you're much older, you're like, how could I ever think this was a good idea? Like, how all these OP elements that looked fun, like, this makes no sense at all. There's no equilibrium to it.
That's not even just true of when you're a kid making games. It's true when you are a professional game designer and you look back at some of the first games you ever made, you're like, wow, how did I ever think this is a good idea?
Yep. I mean, even if you look at the beginnings of Hearthstone too, like how they evolved from everything, or even just games in general, it's very interesting to hear developers talk about the beginning of how they design classes or how they design cards. There's like a lot of interesting facts that people like really don't know too much about that they eventually like balance numbers or it functioned differently, right? Like how would Illidan even be if they actually kept that card destruction mechanism, you know, where you throw away your cards and draw more cards? That would have been really interesting to see, but maybe it would have been really enraging to see. So
I'm really toxic for some decks, right? Like that hold on to cards and then they're forced to lose their answers. Like you're a druid player with a combo you rely on to win, and then they play that, they have nothing to lose, and then you lose your entire combo.
It's the counter to Patron. They discard 10 cards, they draw 10 more. But they lose their Frothing Berserkers.
You know, there's a card in Magic that does that. It's so unplayed, but there was one deck where it was just the most fun thing to do.
Windfall.
It was just so fun to play. Like that, those archetypes where you just manipulate hand size.
Wait, what a Windfall do?
Windfall is really totally busted.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
What is it? You still don't tell me what it does.
Because it could just be used as a massive card draw mechanism. Mm-hmm. The way that it worked was actually both players discard their hands and draw equal to the number of cards that the highest player had.
Yep.
So you could actually just empty your hand, your opponent still has 7 cards, you know, play Windfall, suddenly you have 7 cards again.
Yeah, but your graveyard might be relevant where theirs is not as much, so you kind of break their game plan and you rebuild yours, and it's kind of like, it's kind of a crazy card, basically.
Yeah.
It was really fun. Yeah.
That sounds very cool.
All right, looks like we're getting to the game again, or at least Life Coach is staring at Tiddler intently with that rope.
Yeah, he's waiting for the rope to finish burning before he starts the game.
Ah, I see how it is.
That's
why clever. We're taking a while to get into Life Coach's game.
Unfortunately, that rope will never
doesn't burn. Yeah,
it looks like it. It might look like it on your screen, but it's never going to actually finish burning.
But maybe it's just burning really, really slowly. Hashtag deep.
That's right. You know, also a shout out to our art person. I know a lot of people are asking about it. You know, it's part of like the feature of the Archon team. Like, Kibler, are you happy with your art that was commissioned?
I think it's hilarious. I think it's great.
You look very, I want to say sinister in that picture, because it's like, you know, you're smiling very heavily and it's like you have a dragon that's like your shoulder.
It's actually accurate. Like I do have like fangs. People are like, oh, you look like a vampire. It's like, well, in real life, I actually just have fangs, basically.
Oh, so you are a Time Lord, literally.
I guess so. I didn't want to let that out here on the cast, but
yeah.
I can't lie if I'm after.
It's the NDA.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fine. So there seems to be a spectator bug, oh man, Rope Coach is being announced by the game itself.
I think
the innkeeper just does it.
I think this is like the special microtransaction that you can pay for the Life Coach entry to a game. Yeah. The rope burns down, the game starts.
Like Medivh has, you know, the crows that appear, and Life Coach just has the rope that burns, and then he appears in the game.
Yeah explodes. Oh yeah.
All right, turns out there was an issue on one side of the spectating. I'm not sure what that was. This is Tiddler's hand. All right, so it seems like he's playing patience still. We don't know what Life Coach was playing. Actually, did we see anything? No, just the rope.
He is playing the rope. That's his fundamental strategy with all decks.
Oh, I love that class. I was really hoping that they would bring that to Hearthstone. Oh, okay, never mind. We actually do have the POV.
Oh man, imagine that minion that says like plus one attack for each second left in the turn. So you just interact with the time left on the road.
How about minus one health for each second taking a turn? That would be
great. And it starts with five, so you really have to brush.
I actually was really disappointed in a recent league that I was playing where Life Coach was also in the league, but he wasn't in my group. I fully intended to just play Nosdormu in every single one of my decks against him the week that I played him in the league.
Yeah.
Perfect for glorious. A league too.
Yeah, exactly. It would have been glorious.
Yeah, for sure.
The entire Celestial should have brought at least two decks with Nosdormu.
I mean,
you can plus target Life Coach every single time.
Yeah, exactly. You just have Nosdormu in all of your decks. How can you possibly lose to Nihilum?
Yeah, eventually they're going to... Oh my god, this is the best in Conquest. You can't lose. You're eventually going to win with them. Oh, man.
Because Life Coach will continue to bring Patron. And you have to just drop in Nosdormu. And Recombobulator everything that 9 mana.
But seriously, I'm talking super serious here. How competitive could that be?
I mean, super serious, I don't know. The thing is, it's still a 9 mana minion, so and you have to draw it. So there's going to be lots of games where it's, you know, even if you can totally wreck one of his turns or two of his turns with it, you may have already lost by that point in the game.
Yeah. You could also use Emperor Thorazin to make it a few mana points cheaper, but generally
you could innervate it out, you know? Wild Growth Innervate, that makes things a bit smoother.
All right, well, we figured out what sort of decks we wanted in, but...
Yeah, now the hard part, making it actually work and good. In the process, Life Coach here stuck on, you know, a little bit of an impasse. He doesn't necessarily want to easily part ways with the Fiery War Axe. He could Deathbite down this Frothing Berserker, or he could just leave it alone, or use Inner Rage to get rid of it. Do you find there's one line of play that you like the most here, Kimber?
My inclination, I went to play the Inventor and probably attack Inner Rage it, is what I imagine I would do. But, Frothing Berserker is just a really powerful minion, and you don't... Oh, he just attacks it and does not enrage it. Okay, I can see that, too. I guess with only having one health left on it, it is very vulnerable to his hand, which already contains the two unstable ghouls. One, you know, sort of awkward thing here is that, you know, if Tiddler does just, Deathbite that down, he's going to still need to use additional resources to kill it, and he's going to get hit for the 4 damage, but that's not that big a deal because it does at least turn the battle rage in his hand.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Well, why? I'm actually even confused in the beginning why you dropped Frothing Berserker that early on, but I suppose his hand was looking really weird, so he just ended up going for whatever board presence he could get. Because that is also another key element to victory. Whoever can seize commanding board control early on can pressure the opponent out.
Mm, yeah, I feel like in Patron, though, it very often comes down to the patrons more so than anything else, whereas you'll have other matchups where the Frothings are going to be much more impactful. And like Kalento, for instance, drops Frothing very frequently, let's say against Handlock, and if the Handlock doesn't have the answer, that's it. The game's over. So you're forcing the opponent to have the answer, and if they don't, then you're at least probing. In this instance, I think he might have been trying to probe for Deathbite, but Life Coach gave no information.
Yeah, I mean, here, you know, the amount of damage that you take it's relevant in these games, you know, taking that 4 damage here, because it does come down to, you know, sort of many times an explosive burst turn, or, you know, two turns over which you're taking damage from Brim Patrons. And, you know, right now it looks like Life Coach doesn't want to... Oh, interesting. All right, he got the one hit there, and now he's going and just playing the Deathbite anyway. So just took 8 damage. That's kind of interesting. I wonder what he was hoping to draw that he didn't want to play the Deathbite to overwrite his axe last turn, but then decided to play it this turn.
That was a really interesting move. I was not anticipating just equipping a Deathbite and attacking there.
Oh, he does have the Coin Emperor. That's what it is. There we go.
It does let him do that, which is quite relevant given the game state. At the same time,
he still can do that next turn too, the same exact move, but equip Deathbite and then Inner Rage kill it. Mm-hmm. I guess he does have Deathbite too.
He also could have just played the Deathbite last turn. It wouldn't have
Yeah, you're right. It would have been like, except he wouldn't play the Gnomish, but then
right. We've got to cycle a little bit further through his deck with the Gnomish Inventor. I am by no means a patron expert. I've literally played like 2 games of the deck. So,
oh man,
I like how it's 2 games of everything because you have one game where you're like, all right, I'll try it one more time, and the second game's like, no.
I mean, in a lot of cases, I'll play decks because I want to get some sort of familiarity for the play patterns they have when I do play against them, even if it's not a deck that I'm playing all that much myself. And I do think that playing on the side of a deck that, even if you're not necessarily planning on playing it competitively, has a lot of value.
Oh, definitely. Getting that information for the tempo plays, the small, turn 3, turn 4, the various options that open up to you. Just looking at those will give you insight when you play against them.
This is a really big Emperor Thorason for Tiddler here. He gets to reduce the cost of double Whirlwind, which is huge, going from 1 to 0, and then the Frothing or the Warsong Commander rather, and a Battle Rage. So he has lots of powerful combo pieces that he's now enabled to be able to play for free or for cheaper, in some cases free, and still has the coin, which is actually also a big deal because it can give him that much more of a big combo turn.
Yeah, absolutely. And also one thing it does do too is, it creates this priority to remove it on your opponent's turn. And if he wanted to play Emperor, for example, he can't necessarily do that without giving up a lot. And in this case, it's like Life Coach will prioritize it. He falls that much farther behind in tempo. It's not as good of a turn to play Emperor Thorason. And that's why some of these mirrors, especially if you look at Druid versus Druid, the person that can get ahead in some of those board positions in tempo by playing Emperor Thorason really puts his opponents in an awkward spot.
I mean, Life Coach has no good answer to Emperor here. I mean, he can use multiple resources to deal with it. Like, here he has to Inner Rage Whirlwind to kill.
He wants to get that Emperor.
And then plays his own, which is okay. Yeah, but he just used a lot of his resources, and now doesn't really have nearly as many of the valuable things in his hand to be able to enable. He does still have the Warsong plus Frothing Berserker.
Oh my goodness. Not to mention that he can answer the Emperor right now and
actually,
be able
I think
to build.
That's game, I think. Yeah, goodbye.
Yeah, that's
it. Yeah, it's 6 times 3 plus the weapon. That's it. That's.
He could actually just attack face, right?
Yeah, it's over.
Oh, wait.
Wait, 4.
Wait, what?
He attacks face. He's at 17, and then he gets another patron.
6 patrons.
Whirlwind gets 2 more patrons.
You know, he's got it. He has to do it. Not Miss Lethal Tiddler.
I don't know what's happening.
Tiddler, don't do it.
No,
he's coining Whirlwind for his. Okay, he's gonna Battle Rage.
I guess. I mean, he's got it pretty much already with the Death Spite trigger.
Yeah, I'm fairly certain this ends up being at least close to lethal.
No, it is lethal. I'm pretty convinced that it is.
Like, also, I don't know about you, but that rope seems to be burning a little too fast for my taste. I'm all for like hurrying up, but that was really quick rope burn.
Did he miss lethal because of the rope, or was there just no lethal? Because I thought he had like 12 more damage coming right in from those patrons. Oh, wow.
Oh. There's a 3-3 that didn't attack.
Yeah, there's
oh
a 3-3 that
god.
Not going.
Oh, so is, wow.
Well, does that change? Well, the ghouls can
lose. He's face-palming right here.
Zale style. Yo, how many of those Miss Lethals will we get on Patreon this tournament? This is just... Yeah.
More importantly, how many easy montages will Disguised Toast have of people missing these Lethals?
And can Life Coach win right here? I mean, he has Warsong Frothing double and
stuff. You know, you've got a point, man. Actually. You have a point, but there's no...
That. I actually think this game might just be over now. Like, the other way.
Can't even
Whoa!
This
has so much potential to be crazy epic now.
You know what, Trolden? You got your work cut out for you. Actually, yeah, this is. I think this is gonna be what another 10
he keeps
damage.
Spawning more patrons with the unstable ghoul. They keep dying and spawning.
So he just queued up the actions and passes, and he wins the game.
Oh, he got it! He got it! He's already fist pumping. He knows he got it because the skull mark hit over the face.
Oh my god! Oh wow! Life Coach stealing that win over from Tiddler. Like, this is just a pure steal. It feels dirty to do it, but then you're like, you know what? The rope has had me before. It will have you now. Oh, man.
Better smile, Life Coach. You're on patron camera. Woo! Look at that. 31 damage for the Berserker.
I mean, that is really tough for Tiddler there. You know, knowing that he had just, you know, a split second away from attacking with that Grim Patron into dying on his next turn. Like, that's something that you really have to have the mental fortitude to be able to fight through if you're going to recover from that.
Yeah, and I mean, he knew he had six spots for the patrons, but I think the calculating how many would spawn from the whirlwind is what took him a little bit longer. You know, with the coin play indicated that he had a longer plan, so it took him a little bit too long to get it through. So Lifecore is going to steal this series. You know, undefeated, already sealed up all his matches today.
I mean, stealing is not an appropriate word. That was donated by Tiddler. I think Lifecore just got his top donator of the day.
I mean, one of the things that is difficult about Patron isn't necessarily just the fact that, you know, some of the complication or the complicated math can take a while, but the fact that literally dragging your cards and the animations of your cards can also take a while. You are actually fighting against time more than anything else, which makes it shocking that Life Coach was the one who won the game when he needed to figure something out like that.
Yeah, I mean, he just went
immediately. He takes his time, and Tiddler was the one who didn't quite make it in time to win.
Yeah, and he fed his opponents all the patrons necessary for the win, which otherwise would have been nigh impossible, if not, you know, just actually basically impossible. Like, he gave them the lethal, literally.
I mean, if there weren't six minions or whatever on the side of his board, there's no way Lifecoach is able to kill him. Every single minion represents so much more damage.
Yeah, this is like my game of the day, I think. Like, so far, this has to be the most unexpected outcome of all the matches we've had today, sure. Like, by far.
It's the fact that we weren't entirely sure, and if he would end up missing lethal, then it's like, oh, well, you know, it didn't matter that Tiddler was not able to finish out that turn, but being able to kill him, and then overkill him by a little bit, too, it was like 31 damage over 25, so good stuff. Life Coach is also done. There's no more games that he has to play, so he can go, you know, rest easy and just take it easy and just, like, help his teammates coach through, maybe even help do some scouting, but Tiddler and Frozen Ice has dropped their first games. Now it's just up to Tyson RDU.
Yeah, and there's a Face Hunter in the lineup too. They've got the info.
Yeah, I mean, from Life Coach's position here, you know, while there might be some incentive to be like, oh, I'm done. See you later, guys. You know, you're trying to be a good teammate here. You want to, you know, try and feed your teammates as much information as possible. You know, like yesterday, for instance, I was done after I think our third match, and ended up, you know, trying to gather as much information about the cards in our opponent's deck as possible and be able to, you know, try to advise Trump and Dog on, you know, what they I think they should be playing around, what sort of matchups we should be looking to cue into and things like that.
Yeah, makes sense. I mean, he's not done yet, basically, what you're saying. He's going to just go back, stick around, and...
I mean, it's a team match, you know? Win and lose is a team. So, you know, regardless of what your personal record is, you know, have to rely on the rest of your team winning in order to actually, you know, get out of the match as a winner. So you're invested in it. And, you know, it's important for your teammates just sort of mentally to recognize that you have, you know, their backs, that you're supporting them, you know, even when they might be struggling.
Yeah, let's hope RDU here isn't feeling like the pressure's on him again, because yesterday, again, you know, he was supported by his teammates, but he said openly that he felt like the pressure was really heavy as a result of taking, I think, four of the losses that happened before they ended up winning the entire matches. So RDU, if he's feeling all right today, is probably going to play a little bit more lighthearted.
I mean, your mental state in this kind of thing is very important, especially considering, you know, you have very little time, especially in matches like Patron, to necessarily make all of the correct decisions. And if you're distracted by, oh, I really need to win this game, rather than just thinking about things turn by turn, you know, it can definitely impact your actual play. And, you know, you need to really try to keep things together regardless of how poorly previous matches may have gone.
Yeah. I wonder, though, if Tiddler is going to, you know, go back in with Patient Warrior again, because it seems like it's an all right deck to face off against the rest of the lineup.
And that's exactly what happens. Tiddler queuing up with Warrior into Tice's Rogue.
Well, that's maybe a little less good.
Yeah, the Rogue seems that it has ways to be able to deal with a lot of the Warrior's annoyances. But the one thing that Rogue sometimes allows Warrior to do is that if Rogue doesn't draw really aggressively and keeps up the ammo through sprint, then it just gives a lot of time for the opponent to recover, right? Where you're just being able to play one card at a time, Warrior deal with it, and then you don't really have anything to end the game, and they just completely burst you out.
Mm. I mean, as a warrior, what you're really looking to do is contain the rogue's early minions. Like your weapons are by far the most important thing here. You know, fiery war axe and death spite, so that they're not able to just get continuous pressure on you. As a rogue, I think what you're looking for, generally speaking, are your sticky minions. Things like piloted shredder are really strong in this matchup because they aren't just able to be removed by the warrior's best cards against you.
Yeah, it's one of the few cards I can go toe-to-toe with Deathspite, and sometimes in rare instances even be better for it. But on the same edge, you've also adjusted for this matchup for a few things. Some warriors have been so prominent that rogues are not running Violet Teachers as commonly, maybe not even running any. Some people are also going for Harrison Jones in their rogue deck to try to make their Patron Warrior matchups even better. So
yeah,
I'm looking forward to see if Tice has any of that.
I think Harrison Jones is one of the most important tech cards in Hearthstone right now, with the popularity of Patron Warrior. I actually think a lot of classes may even want to play Ooze, because you can actually guaranteed kill a Deathspite before it can enable patrons. Whereas, you know, sometimes if your opponent's on the coin, or rather if you're on the coin, you don't necessarily have you have to use the coin specifically for Harrison Jones in order to remove your opponent's Deathspite on time.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, you could always do that if you have an Ooze as well.
Yeah, that's a good argument. You're right, because the Ooze is like you're using them for the same purpose. Sure, the cycle is good, but very often you can also get the almost same effect for a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Noxious, I feel like we were casting a series earlier this week together where we saw someone running two Oozes and Harrison. There's just so much weapon hate overall in that.
Yeah.
Deck.
Oh my God, who was that? That might have been. It was definitely in the Vulcan League, where they could target. Oh yes, it was Kuvdon versus Bunny Muffins, who was running like very aggressive Face Hunter and Face Pally, and his opponent had like two heal bots, two Oozes, and one Harrison, and just something absolutely insane.
Yeah, it was awesome.
That's what it was.
It's no Nose Dormu, but
yeah, but you know, you do what you can against Face Hunter.
No worries. You laugh now, but maybe in a couple of years or so, yeah.
They make it a 412, and it's actually like... That already makes it better. Yeah, it'd be nice.
Alright, so here we are actually into the game.
Yes.
Tiddler as Warrior once again, Tice as the Rogue. Neither of them with a particularly exciting couple of early turns. Tiddler does have a very good opening hand, though. The Acolyte of Pain, Frothing, and Deathspite, along with Battle Rage, let him really piece together all the tools he needs, and he's not really facing down any aggression from the rogue side.
Yeah, I think the key is really being able for the warrior to cycle through, like you mentioned. The pressure early on is almost non-existent, because rogue has such good efficient removal, and ways to even tempo you if you try to make something significant. That's why a lot of people who, when they initially start playing Patron, is like, well, it's an empty board. You know, do I ever drop this Frothing Berserker just straight up to try to challenge? You don't necessarily need to, because you can focus on drawing through Battle Rage, get the Deathspite, get the Acolytes going, and then the Frothings become that much stronger as the game develops.
Yeah, and here, you know, Tiddler, yeah, he's going to, I imagine, develop the Deathspite, just go straight to the face, allows him to set up for possible, turn with maybe Acolyte plus Armorsmith next turn. Really what Tiddler's looking to do is dig through his deck, find the sort of pieces he wants to put together.
Because if you play your Acolyte alone at this point, number one, you're not enabling it on its own, and then you're vulnerable to, you know, Drake plus Backstab or Deadly Poison play, which, you know, are very standard openings for Rogue. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a waste.
Yeah, I mean, when you're playing against Rogue as a deck that is capable of playing a longer game, in many cases, you'll want to try to do that, because you can leverage the fact, or get back some of the tempo that the rogue is actually usually able to generate with cards like Backstab, when it's able to, you know, use its early turns to get value there. And if you're not letting them do that, you end up in a significantly better position. You see exactly the... Speak to me. Are we seeing Armorsmith? No Armorsmith. Okay.
Yeah,
they're probably just going to stack as much as you can.
Yeah, well, he just uses Hero Power instead.
Yeah, not, I was gonna say.
Oh, he's not damaged past the oops. He has no actual damage on his health. So that's a bad Battle Rage. Good thing he didn't do that. Terrible play.
Dice with a double prep, and I mean with the prep and the double sprint, like he doesn't have many options board wise. Like he would have loved a shredder or something. Anything here would have been pretty much better than having to prep sprint, because it's still leaving you with a bit too many cards, and then you can't backstab because the thing is damaged. So you kind of have to deadly poison after this to kill the Acolyte. And even then,
Yeah, this is like one of those really awkward scenarios. But the nice thing is that Rogue does have ultimate board clear potential because they have cards like Blade Flare, like we're talking about. So he can afford to dump a little bit of this and then try to refill his hand so he'd be well equipped. But in the resource war and the acquisition war, I think Patron in the end is the one that gets the better of it. So
well, he's going to be overdrawing by one card at least during this game. Let's hope it's nothing too important for him, because otherwise this could feel terrible. But he's got the Celsi deckhand with Double Thinker, Sharp Sword, so I don't think he'll be feeling too bad about it. Second prep would be devastating to lose, though.
Yeah. Well, it's a pretty clear Emperor Thoris in play. Just want to reduce the cost of all these things. Also interesting to note that Tiddler is one of the few warriors, I feel like, are still running Gromash as one of the main finishers or burst potentials. And with so many cheap activators, it feels like that might be a relevant force, considering that he already has also a Frog and Berserker.
Mm-hmm.
But in this matchup, I actually think that Gromash is actually a pretty powerful card. The Rogue has a lot of ways to deal with your ability to create a big board full of patrons, and doesn't really play all that much to the board itself. So you're not really in a position where you can frequently get those huge frothing Berserker kills later on. But the Rogue is using its life total as a resource, so the burst damage from Gromash can definitely come down and end the game in short order.
Yeah, that was an interesting turn from Thais as well. I mean, he decided to eviscerate instead of using the deadly poison on his dagger to kill Emperor, knowing that he does need that health. You know, you mentioned he's using it as a resource, but he will do it pretty much every time. But against Patron, they have to be very cautious, and they know that. Like, every player who plays Rogue against Patron knows that if you're too reckless, you'll just get one-shotted, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the one-turn kill.
I mean, it's important to recognize that while your life total is a resource,
you need to
be careful about using it, in particular against decks that are capable of a lot of burst damage like Patron is.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's why Thais is playing this very well here.
Yeah, I definitely like that particular play. And here we do see a Violet Teacher in Thais's deck, which, as we've mentioned, can definitely be a liability in this matchup. I wonder if he has Violet Teacher in addition to the Piloted Shredders or instead of, because that's usually one of the places where Rogue decks kind of have a bit of a variation. But it looks like, he's just going aggro.
So that's 15 damage total from just those two hits. Yeah. Unless he can still hold
onto this weapon too for like next turn if something happens. Also, I think with the Goblin Auto Barber, I think this list also runs the Assassin's Blade because it gives it a lot more potency to the blade that you don't feel like you have to attach an oil to because it gets too expensive. So I think Thais has a lot of weapon damage coming up here, and if Tiddler can't be threatening the push for a win soon, then it might be the opposite way where Rogue is the one looking to get its combos off and end the game.
And this, I like this from Tiddler. Just he's able to use the Whirlwind to both kill the minion that Thais has in play and activate Gromash. And that 10 is a lot of damage, and 8 is a lot of health. So that's going to be a difficult minion for Thais to actually get rid of.
I mean, Goblin Auto Barber, Tinkers, and Phase Blade Flurry. The problem with that play is that then your Assassin's Blade, if you get it, is going to be reliant on getting the name of the other one? Yeah, the Deadly Poison number 2.
But even if you get it, though, I think it's okay because it's still repetitive damage. Like, you can see the Assassin's Blade as like an investment of damage over the next few turns.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah, that Auto Barber was actually a pretty good draw because he needed to draw something that... I guess he doesn't need to draw anything to enable the Tinkers. He could have just cast Tinkers naturally.
Yeah, but it would have felt a little weird because you're wasting the damage buff, right?
Right, exactly. You end up wasting that otherwise.
Oh, that's quite a bit of damage right there.
Another big swing.
Guys, this game escalated very quickly. Smacking each other.
Just kind of hanging out to, everything suddenly taking tons of damage.
Yeah.
And what could... I mean, like, there's a lot of armor gain here for Tiddler if he wants it. Or at least a little bit of armor gain. If he gets the patrons out, he's got the Whirlwind. Mm-hmm. He's got the Slam if he wants to use it.
Yeah, he's also got Battle Rage to also fill up his hand a little bit.
No, I think he's going to do very well here. With the Execute can be used if he doesn't want to use the Slam on it and just get another patron from it. Since he's seen one Blade Flurry, it's less likely his opponent has a second one.
Slam will be really useful for inevitable drops like Azure Drakes and Vile Teachers if he can't answer this turn. Ooh, man, it's looking... Even though the Rogue got a huge combo off, it's still looking a little bit tough for it to come back from this
position. It's looking grim.
Well, the problem was he needed to use Blade Flurry there in order to remove just one minion. He didn't actually use the Blade Flurry to remove the big board. And that's what he really needs it for. You know,
yes.
And that's why, you know, as I was saying, I think that Grommash is really powerful in this matchup specifically, because normally the Rogue's answer to a big minion is Sap. And well, Grommash is not a particularly good minion in the Sap because he just comes right back down and does 10 damage.
Yeah, or even game-ending damage because you're at 15, he had a Fiery War Axe. If he had an Inner Rage or if he had a cool Taskmaster that was reduced in cost, that was the game. So.
Certainly.
And Tice having to use a full 7-mana sprint here is just feels so disastrous. But he doesn't really have any other plays. I mean, he could potentially, you know, play Violet Teacher, but that's terrible into a Grim Patron. Backstab can only currently target Grim Patron.
He had a Violet Teacher Sap Eviscerate play.
He needs to pick up another Flurry, right? That's basically his best out, is finding another Blade Flurry.
He has to dig to Flurry, but right now he even needs to dig to Flurry and a way to boost the damage. He has Azure Drake, but that only boosts it by one.
I'd have to use Assassin's Blade on the Flurry right away, which is...
With this War
Song? Oh yeah, with the War Song, I think it might be. With the Cruel Task.
Oh, I think so, because he can Cruel Task and Slam.
War Song, Frothing, Slam, Cruel.
Yeah. That should be it. Lethal.
It's a million damage, so I hope that kills someone. That's, you know.
Warrior! Dealing a million damage since 1921. So my question is...
1921?
Specifically, yes.
What happened in 1921? Our economy collapsed.
What?
The Hearthstone Alpha was a long time ago.
Yeah, it started off like a long time. Druids were OP back then, man.
Good job there.
She does get a win with the patron player.
All right, just marking it down here. So that's the first win here for Team Celestia, which is good. And if Tiddler lost, then he would have been benched, which is still not the end of the world, but very inconvenient if your opponent's up 3-0 over you.
I mean, I do think that's also a big win for Tiddler after his miscalculation in the previous game. You know, coming out of that kind of situation, a win definitely helps a lot to get you sort of back in the right mental state.
Right, just the focus, we'll see. I wonder if he's going to be queuing up his next deck into this, because he can now, you know, as he's not benched, or if Silent Storm is going to come out. Maybe he hasn't played a single game yet. We've seen Frozen Ice's Hunter. Tiddler's Warrior's already locked up, so maybe Silent Storm will come out with his own deck.
Yeah, I don't know. I think RDU might be gravitating towards the aggressive Paladin, but that's what he did the last week, so perhaps he doesn't want to bring in, he's going to mix it up. But last week, RDU brought the aggressive Paladin versus Silent Storm isn't really the aggressive deck type of player. He really likes doing the mid-range control style stuff. For better or for worse, sometimes he creates really weird decks. I think one of the coolest things I saw Silent Storm recently do was put Toshley into Druids and really try to use the spare parts accordingly to help him. Not to mention that it was like really effective body as 5/7 was difficult for any class to remove. And that was like a small thing that he tries to always do with all of his decks. Just really find those flexible spots and put his own flavor and twist on it.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's an argument to be made for Toshley just as a straight up body. Like, it's no Boulderfist Ogre, but you get the upside that comes with it. And that's always something to consider. I know for a while it was actually pretty okay if you were facing off against a lot of Tempo Mage when they were running counterspells all the time. So that was pretty fun. We just get a spare part and waste it.
I actually really liked Toshley and was playing it a lot right when it came out. I was playing it in Priest with both the fact that you get a spare part for Wild Pyromancer, as well as you just have a 7 health minion that you can heal that can, you know, go toe-to-toe specifically with Savannah High Main.
Right.
Most minions of the same cost, you know, can't actually fight Savannah High Main and win other than, you know, Boulder Fist Ogre, which I actually had to
represent at some
point for exactly that reason.
I think Frodan's got something with the Ogre.
Huh? What was that?
I think Frodan's got something with the Ogre. He hypes it up a lot.
He's the only ogre that does what I tell him to do. I swear I tried so hard to make
the Magi. What about the Magi? No love for the Magi? Come on, man.
I don't
four play four for four.
I try to win. I try to
be smart.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah. No. I'm just saying. Like, I've had so many bad experiences with Ogre Brood, but Boltfist Ogre, man, it's especially if you're playing on a new account. Like, I'm trying to climb Asia once in a while. Boltfist Ogre surprises me.
I actually had a game in the Tavern Brawl yesterday where I played Recycle on my opponent's Mogor and got my own Mogor.
It was
a very fast process of recycling the Mogor.
Wow.
So nature does what it knows best.
Technology's advanced so far.
Oh, and this is, we see the very different version of Paladin from RDU now. Zombie Chow, not the kind of card that goes into the aggressive deck that he was playing in last week's matches.
No, not
And this is actually, this is something that I think is a good general strategy for teams in the league, because you don't want your opponents to be able to really pick up on your tendencies and play specifically to beat the decks that they expect you to bring. If you keep bringing the same style of deck for the same class, then they'll already know in the mulligan stage of the game what sort of cards they're looking for, and that can be a pretty big deal. You know, knowing that you want to mulligan for, say, Zombie Chow because you're playing against an aggressive deck can be the difference between winning and losing in a game.
Yeah,
I agree. Not to mention that RDU is well experienced with this deck. He's not switching. Sometimes people switch for the sake of switching, and they're not well experienced for it, and I don't even really mind talking about it much because he's willing to admit it, but Nimsh in the past was like trying really hard to not be predictable as an aggro player. So he started playing like a lot of really heavy control decks, like Control Paladin, which was not his forte. And it was just like, it actually really suffered some of his matchups. But RDU is not like that. Even though he's been playing a lot of aggro recently, if you recall some of the tournaments that he won last summer, he was playing things like Kael the Zod, super control heavy paladin. So he's very versatile in some of his playstyles, which also makes it even much more threatening when you bring that to a team dynamic, because they can be capable of playing any type of deck.
Yeah, I mean, I know that in our match yesterday, we actually were specifically trying to queue decks into Forsen's Warlock deck that we thought were good against Zoo, because Forsen has not only played Zoo last week in the team league, but historically has tended to play more aggressive decks. Yeah. And then he was playing, Malygos, Warlock, and Freeze Mage last week. It's the sort of thing that can really get you, even like minor edges in single games in matches can be a really big deal.
Yes. All yes. Right,
so
absolutely.
Looking at the board state here, that like this is pretty much a nightmare for the Hunter player, but the Misha might kind of equalize things if RDU decides to Aldor it and he starts damaging his Zombie Chow, and then maybe he can pick up some value with Unleash the Hound, but for now it's not looking exactly stellar for the Hunter player.
Yeah, the Misha, you're just worried about a couple things because your opponent's on the coin. True Server Champion allows you to answer it. Not even that, but even if he just traded directly into Misha, lost his Zombie Chow, he could play Pilot Shredder or something that just you don't really have a lot of ways to answer it, and you need to be able to get this board advantage early on.
But, this is what what Frozen Ice might have been somewhat waiting for, is the ability to really get something done. Because after Aldor is hit, then suddenly the Zombie Chow starts being more vulnerable to Explosive Trap and some damage from your Hounds. But then again, you're still not putting maybe enough pressure to feel comfortable about it.
Is he going to try to play around Consecration? I mean, we know that RDU doesn't have it, but Frozen Ice could hedge his bets by picking off, say, the Aldor Peacekeeper, because it's the 3 health minion, and that way everything that trades in is a little bit awkward.
I think with Juggle Unleashed in your hand, you just want to go face.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking too. It's like, you just go face, he'll make the trades. If he consecs, you just get another wave of Hounds, and you hope that he doesn't pick up, let's say, a Sludge Belcher without your Owl, and you just kind of try to go for it. Make a run for the win.
Yeah, I mean, he does go to face, which I definitely like.
You like the face? You like going face, don't you?
Well, I like going face. That's okay. That's my style.
Face has taunt.
It does.
That's not too bad. Let's him get a knife with the possible card draw follow-up if he wants. It's kind of overextending into another Unleash, but...
Yeah, what's also really interesting is... I wonder if there's any hesitation from Frozen Ice to make RDU not think that he has the second Unleash the Hounds. I mean, you're already not pegging them on it by, but in general, like, you're trying to make him think he has certain options, because now RDU is going to want to trade stuff, generally speaking, to make sure to reduce the normal minions on board, but he also wants to make sure to keep it as much high value, right? So because things like the mini bot doesn't trade into a 2-attack minion, it's another Unleash the Hound dog that comes out.
Oh man, RD is not going to be happy to see this at all. Oof.
Where these juggles go?
This has to hurt.
Well, there's still hope in the top of the deck. In the consecration.
That's why I thought he was going to play the Acolyte, just to get the card draw, but nope. We'll see where it goes from here. Ah.
Hmm.
That's good, actually, right?
It's okay.
I mean, you're weak to Owl, so you don't feel too comfortable with it. You're also weak to a weapon and quick shot.
I mean, the problem is it's not necessarily, you know, like, just establishing a board presence right now. It's just your life total so low. You know, when you're at 15 against this board as a paladin, you know, and here he's forced to, you know, ends up having to use his coin on the acolyte, which means that next turn doesn't really have any plays. Like, he doesn't have, you know, he kind of wanted to be able to eventually coin boom, mm-hmm. but this is definitely pretty strong because it does force your opponent to give you at least a card draw. But we know that Frozen Ice has the quick shot in his hand, which means that that's not really gonna, you know, stop the board he has in play. And if this animal companion is something good, either Huffer or Leok,
one. That's like, yeah, you know, there's no consecration, so you can just be fine with giving multiple minions extra attack.
Oop, there's land hands, but there's not that much mana.
Yeah, to say the least. Yeah, he just needs to pick slow. Up like Wow, this is just a complete blowout.
Oh yeah, RD's just dead. He's just dead.
Started really, really badly for the Hunter player, but then RD with the outdoor Peacekeeper play on Misha, like lowering the health of his minions, and then Frozen Ice had the double Unleash and picked up the Juggler. That was pretty much exactly what he wanted to see.
Well, I mean, Unleash the Hounds is one of the best cards against Paladin, for much the same reason that Patron ends up preying on Paladin sort of in the late game, because Paladin is so much about establishing this board presence that in order to defend itself, it needs to play out minions, and that can very easily get punished, as we saw right there, with Unleash, and certainly with Juggler Unleash.
Yeah, I think that Knife Juggler might have been the card that pushed it over the edge.
Yeah, well, just in general, the fact that Paladin had no play, like, Hunter will generally have plays, because it curves out really aggressively. So if it was a Knife Juggler, it might have been, you know, another weapon pushing phase, or it could have been a Charger pushing phase. And there's just nothing that Paladin can do if you have a quality and all your late game cards. It's rather unlucky, if you think about it, that RDU has maybe four or five cards that are six mana and above, and he drew like three of them. So it's just like really awkward when that happens. Yeah. But he also had Zombie Chow early on, and he couldn't capitalize. So he got some of the good, he got some of the bad, and ended up being a loss.
The curve of Chow into Minibot into Aldor into Juggler is pretty strong. You know, it's difficult to ask for a much better opening hand as a Paladin. But, you know, without the actual ways to clear the board like Consecration, without ways to restore your health like Healbot, is a, you know, it's a pretty big deal. Yeah, you really need those to be able to stay in the mid game.
Well, series is tied, guys. 2-2. Frozen Ice also gets a win, and that's RDU's first appearance and loss. RDU has not performed well last week, and I think he's looking to bounce back for certain. But the field has narrowed down a little bit. Both warriors are out of the way, but the Hunter and Warlock has been split here. Still rather even. The only question marks remain over, for example, what Warlock and Paladin of Silent Storm playing, because I think everything else has been figured out by now.
Yeah, and I mean, Celestial must be really happy that they got the win with their Phase Hunter, because again, you know, the more information you have about that deck, just knowing that it is what it is, your mulligan changes a lot, right? So having sealed the win, even though the start from the Paladin seemed really strong, that's going to give you, you're back on equal field, because even if you had, you know, lost this game with another deck, or won this game with another deck, you would have still been behind as far as information.
I mean, the classes that have significantly different styles that they can play, specifically Warlock, is the most sort of diverse in terms of the, you know, what you want against different versions of Warlock. Being able to conceal that information until later seems quite valuable. The fact that no one at this point going against Silent Storm knows, okay, do I want to mull against Zoo? Do I want to mull against Handlock? Do I want to mull against Demonlock or against, you know, Malagos? There's just so many different styles you can actually present. And getting to the later rounds without having to reveal that information has a lot of value.
Yeah, you can pin him, like, you can make educated guesses about what they're going to be playing, but that means nothing, right? In a team league where they might have discussed things over, maybe he'll be willing to go out of his comfort zone, play a deck that he doesn't usually play, have some practice partners to really, you know, get some experience in if necessary. And Sunstorm's already a very versatile player anyway.
I think it just becomes increasingly more punishing the later you find out into the stage of what deck it is. Mm-hmm. But we'll cross that bridge when we get there. In the process, we have Druid versus Rogue coming out here. Druid being one of the iconic classes for Tice for a long time. He's utilized his class to have some of his tournament wins as well as his high placings. Even his ridiculous King of the Hill reign when he beat like 11 or 10 people in a row, which includes some of the best players in the world there. Tice has been very experienced with this class.
It's not been doing so well for other players, but Tice is still one of the exceptions where whenever he seems to play the deck, it kind of just works. I've seen him play in multiple tournaments. Let's say he very often brings Druid, and it doesn't seem to ever really fail him as much as it does other players. He does get the unfortunate losses. You know, it happens to everyone when you don't get the Wild Growth, you know, innervate, and the opponent does in a mirror match. But when it comes to facing off against, you know, not symmetrical matches, then he seems to always get something done.
I mean, Druid is definitely a class that has the ability to beat anything and the ability to lose to anything.
Yeah. Very polarized in the way that it actually comes out on the board.
I mean, it's so much of its power is typically heavily reliant on, you know, the two acceleration cards, Wild Growth and specifically the timing when you draw them. Yeah, if you're drawing Wild Growth turn 2, Innervate turn 3.
I know that. I casted that game of you when you were playing Druid, Kibler, and you had like double Wild Growth, double Savage Roar, double Innervate, and nothing else. Like that was the worst game ever to watch.
Sometimes that's what happens to you. That's your life.
But, oh man. That was a great game to
never
watch.
Never lucky baby rage or whatever, but
yeah. It was priceless because at first your hand looked really good, and then after the second Innervate, we were really getting worried, and it didn't seem to really improve. All right, so the Shade's been developed already on turn 4, a bit off curve, no Shredder, which would have been a bit better here to handle the Violet Teacher. He's gonna have to find another way to do that.
I mean, he does have the swipe in his hand, which makes Violet Teacher much less scary than it otherwise might be.
Yeah,
and in particular, he has swipe and Wrath, so when he gets to 6 mana next turn, if he does just leave this Violet Teacher here, he does have the option of just clearing it with Violet Teacher and cycling Wrath.
So do you just play, say, Druid of the Claw in taunt mode and let him sap it or backstab Eviscerate, use some resources, and then you can just hero power down and swipe the Violet Teacher?
Yeah, I like just bearing up here. I think that seems like your best option.
Yeah.
I mean, none of the other options are really particularly appealing. You don't want to, you know... You don't want to have an incredibly inefficient turn by just cycling Wrath and Violet Teacher now, or just hero power now.
Is there any like subtle thing that you want Violet Teacher to build minions so you can get actual value off Mind Control tech? Or probably not. I think you still want to deal with Violet Teacher as the threat itself.
Because the thing is, if Violet Teacher is building up minions and you play Mind Control tech, the most likely thing you get is a 1/1 student, and that's... No, if you're giving your opponent a lot of time and playing your resources inefficiently to get something so low impact, especially against Rogue who just has, you know, Dagger and Fan of Knives, just doesn't seem worth it.
Yep, I can see that for sure.
Well, yeah, I can't even play MC Tech anyway.
Well, dealing with this Violet Teacher is important, but I like this setup with the Thanos too, because you definitely want to get that cycle. Save the Sap is just so powerful for any taunts that eventually come out too, or big minions.
Yeah, I mean, Sap, he doesn't necessarily know, Frozen Eyes doesn't necessarily know if Tice is playing a version that is, you know, maybe more big minion heavy. We have seen some players, you know, the deck that I used this week, you know, with Ancient of War, which if you use your saps on some of the sort of early or mid game minions can definitely punish you for that.
Yeah, you can get Lotheb's. I think Lotheb is one of the main targets by the Ancient War actually that you mentioned. I've seen a few players incorporate this in their list, and it's mostly able to snipe those Lotheb's that otherwise try to come out and really negate your turn 6 and 7. Mm-hmm. That's one thing I really like about it.
I mean, I think in general, the metagame is pretty aggressive right now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Ancient of War is a pretty powerful card against a lot of those aggressive decks. You know, even over, I mean, our deck lists are going to be posted, you know, soon. And so, I mean, I didn't even have Dr. Boom in my deck. You know, I just had the Ancient of War because they were able to stop the aggression far more effectively than Dr. Boom can.
Hmm. Yeah, it's a good proactive card, but as far as reacting to stuff, not so good. At least not very often. If it's an even field, you might be able to push it back, but if you're already behind, it does absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, speaking of
the good doctor.
That is perfect, actually. Is it?
It's kind of. Yeah, almost as good as it gets.
Yeah, because you don't really get to sap this. Like, I think Dr. Boom and Rag are the two prime examples. Maybe with Emperor now, where you really don't want to sap them. As an answer, mm-hmm. The oil. Yeah,
anything that has an immediate game impact, sap is much less attractive against. I mean, mm-hmm. just like we saw in the previous game, where you know sap was certainly not a good answer to the Grommash against the warrior.
No, it almost led to certain death. In this scenario, though, Rogue still traditionally struggles with big health minions. In fact, I've been seeing some rogues run the big game hunter into their decks too, because they just were tired of dying to stupid things. Like, for example, you know, the rogue feels like it should have an advantage tempo wise over decks like Zoo, but then when the occasional Mal'Ganis came out, it was actually insta lose if you don't have sap. So they started running things like big game hunter and whatnot to deal with really big threats. Not to mention that they sometimes do get this position where they're behind on board and Dr. Boom's out. What are you supposed to do? You're just going to fight inefficiently, or you're going to stall for time?
Well, it seems like he's gonna have to stall for time here and try to get something done a bit later. I mean, the blade is nice, but it's not fast it's not fast enough that you can really start pushing for, you know, a big oil turn and, you know, recurrent damage. You really want to get that a bit later when you've already secured the board, which I think is the biggest weakness of Rogue in some way, that it needs the board to do anything very often.
Yeah, I mean,
like Patron.
Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead. I'm done.
I was just gonna say when you have a minion in play as a rogue. You know, the card Tinker's Sharp Sword Oil becomes so much more threatening.
Right.
You can enable it with the deck hand, but that's a really vulnerable minion, especially, you know, there's lots of different classes that can do one damage quite easily. If you have it on a bigger minion, even like, you know, say this SI agent, that takes a lot more for your opponents to be able to deal with effectively.
This is not a position I'd like to be in if I'm Frozen Ice.
No, this is an awkward spot, for sure.
You have to cycle. I mean, there's a way to kill it for sure, but you have to face tank, you know, seven, but...
I'm trying to see if there's maybe a way for him to potentially say, you know what, I can't play around combos, so I'm just going to try to kill.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
And I don't think there's any way for him to play around combo at this point, pretty much from regardless.
So I think if he goes really aggressive, as opposed to super defensive, like Healbot, there might be an opportunity to draw Blade Flurry. Like, if he attaches a deadly poison on the Assassin's Blade now and wax, he can do up to 10 damage. And then next turn, he might have the ability to go for a huge Blade Flurry with...
Like, I mean, he can kill Dr. Boom at least. I think he'll at least want to do that with the Tinkers up and his dagger. Okay. That's a very simple way to...
That's fine, too.
To remove some of the board.
Either way, the game's like... Oh, he's trading. Oh,
yeah,
man.
Yeah. He was pushing for the trade a little bit, but that's really bad. If you're gonna wee, that's really bad for him, because if he's gonna be weak to combo, I think that's pretty much game over anyway.
Well, no, thankfully he did, because the Drew the Claw plus Savage Roar, I think, was lethal there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, his minions in play weren't really worth keeping around against the two boom bots. That's the thing.
Yeah,
it's true.
Very likely to actually die to the boom bots, and they're pretty very close to, you know, almost guaranteed to die to the boom bots, including the hero power.
Yeah, it doesn't feel good if you're the rogue player here, but then again, what choice do you have? You're really cornered. The Dr. Boom forcing a sap out of you when you don't have like a backstab eviscerate with some sort of spell damage, because very often that's what ends up happening. It'd be like Drake with backstab eviscerate or deadly poison set up and then eviscerate.
This is definitely a horrible spot if you're the rogue.
Yep.
Yeah, you're getting...
Dice is feeling really confident that, hey, what if you even Blade Flurry me? Fine, you might die.
Yeah.
Those boom bots might just give me the win.
Oh, like, I feel so nervous to just fan of knives or something, you know? It's scary.
Oh man, he's gonna have to Healbot and then Phantom Knives.
Healbot, then Phan.
Alright. Well, he might still go down to 2 health, right?
Yeah. Imagine if he goes down to 2 health and he just dies anyways. From the next draw. Oh.
He's going to 7. Lucky 7, maybe. We'll see.
7 is still lethal with for the Force of Nature, which could have been drawn, but in this case, it's back to the drawing board here.
Wow.
And that shade will sit there.
There's Shade and Force of Nature. They're really, unless Frozen Ice gets a Blade Flow.
That is actually exactly the card he wanted, but he's still dead.
Yeah, he's still dead.
There's a silver lining. He got to do one last thing before he went the graveyard way.
Looks damage, but he's exactly dead anyway. He's actually slightly more than exactly dead because of the keep.
Oh, yeah, you're right. He's like over dead.
Yeah. The BM overkill.
Does he want to show that he plays Keeper in his Druid deck?
I don't think he'd want to do that. I mean, I know that Tides of Time was running one Keeper in his one of his lists a long time ago. So again, you know, just don't
still
show that.
Still had all these. Boom.
All right, so that means the Druid's able to get a win. Druid's been struggling a lot in the ATLC, but looks like Nylon was able to get that win. Very important here. And Frozen Ice gets his second loss here. So that's 3-2 for Nylum.
Yeah. They're feeling really good probably at the moment. I mean, RDU, again, you know, the focus really needs to come back for him. He needs to get a win in order to maybe get back into it because he spoke again yesterday about him feeling a little down. So we'll see if he can pull off a win against one of the other players. Silent Storm is still a big unknown for Nihilum right now. Like Paladin and Warlock, what do you think they're going to pin Silent Storm on based on past performances?
Well, I feel like Hunter here is still relatively okay against pretty much everything. You know Druid's out there. Rogue, of course, still struggles sometimes with the Hunter. And I always feel confident whatever Paladin that the Hunter goes up against. So I feel like this could be a good opportunity for RDU to sneak in, get his first win. If your opponents are predicting that, then they'll go ahead and play the deck that they feel like is best against Hunter, so that way they can sneak that out too. But right now, I'm definitely leaning towards Nylum. I like the fact that Hunter's still available here, and they give a lot of chances for Paladin, because that's my big thing. I just want the most chances for what they perceive to be the weakest deck here.
I mean, it's you know, it's difficult to say what deck they might necessarily feel is weak here. I mean, RDU with the Paladin, we don't know what Warlock Silent Storm's playing. We don't know what Paladin Silent Storm's playing. Paladin is typically pretty weak to Rogue. It's one of the rough matchups because they do have the Blade Flurry tools to clear your board late, as well as good tempo tools to keep you from getting an early board presence. So that looks like it may be the sort of linchpin of Nihilum being able to win this match is getting that Paladin through to a reasonable matchup.
Yeah, you're right, actually. Maybe the Warlock's not actually too bad. I mean, if you're facing off against a Zeus, say from Silent Storm, that's a really good matchup for Paladin, I'd say. And Headlock is also not out of the question. It's one of those decks you can always somehow get wins against nowadays, because the Divine Shields really make it a bit difficult for the Warlock players, where they have to use a lot of recurring damage sources to deal with the Divine Shield, and they have to Hellfire later. So they've got all these little pressure points that you can sometimes sneak in and then turn the tide around where they can't remove the board.
Yeah, I'm playing mid-range Paladin. I'm generally pretty happy to run into any Warlock deck except for the Malygos combo decks.
Yeah.
that's a deck that's able to, you know, just burst you down in a single turn from very little board presence. And against Zoo, against Handlock, stuff like Equality Consecrate, you know, Muster for Battle, these are all just, you know, reasonably strong cards to begin with. And here we will see Silent Storm playing Warlock, and we'll find out what it is.
That's good. That's good. I was worried that maybe Silent Storm was like not even awake. You know, at this point he's like, "All right, guys, I'm gonna take a nap. Wake me up when you need me," type thing. Yeah. He's just been sitting out the first 5 games.
It was kind of funny that Trump was talking yesterday about, you know, how you know, the 10 a.m. start time was so early for him because he usually sleeps later than that. And I was just like, okay, well, hopefully you're at least awake in time for you needing to play your first match.
Yeah, and you know, guys like Tiddler, it's 3 a.m. for them when the event starts. You know, right now it's like 5 a.m. I think. So
you gotta reconfigure your schedule around Hearthstone. Like your entire life cycle revolves around when and where the tournament sun rises. It's kind of a weird thing.
It is really interesting, you know, seeing how many players are playing late the night wherever they are. You know, I I remember recording the first Challenge Stone deck building portion, and I was like, oh, it's almost midnight, and people were like, I've been awake for 20 hours already. Why are you complaining that it's almost midnight? Oh, I guess that's exactly. A little worse.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, like Orange had slept last time. We saw him play last time. I think he hadn't slept in like 30 hours.
I think it's funny. I think
Korea.
Yeah. I think it's funny because I think Hearthstone, like especially over the past 6 months, has like truly spoiled me. Because it's like, what do you mean I can't play Hearthstone in a tunnel when I disconnect for 5 seconds? It's like, Ferdinand, you should be focusing on driving on the road. You shouldn't be playing Hearthstone on your Android phone as you're driving on the highway. It's like, shut up, Logic. You know, I just want to play some cards. Kind of what happens. People just get really, in that mindset for card games. It changes people. Here we go into game number 6. We have Rogue versus the Warlock, and we don't know exactly what type of Warlock. Silent Storm's capable of playing all kinds of styles, from the aggressive Zeus to the Demon Locks. I haven't actually seen him play Handlock in a while, so maybe it'd be cool to see him bust that out. An old school style.
So he's played it quite a bit.
Oh, yeah. He played a lot of Demon Lock. Silent Storm was known for innovating the first competitive version of Demon Lock that we got to see. I know Dark Wannix tried a little bit, but it was more of an OTK style. And Silent Storm was taking that and innovating even further with more board control aspects of it.
Yeah, Dark Wannix played the Falcon.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he did it to you. Oh, yeah. I remember that.
And then Silent Storm played the sort of Mistress of Pain version that he won the ESL championship with.
Yes.
Zoo deck here is like for rogues. I think this is arguably the worst of the rogue. The warlock matchups. But with that hand, I don't think it's undoable.
This hand looks quite good.
Yeah, it's
substantial. The thing is, you often dump cards. So if And Warlock's gotten so good at fighting back on board with things like Implosion, and if you don't have the AoE, then you just start fighting at a big card deficit. But he even has ways to refill that too with like Prep Sprint. So this is great for Tice.
Yeah, I mean, as far as cards you're looking for against minion heavy decks, having both Backstab and SI and the coin to start the game is pretty much as much as you can ask for.
But Silent Storm just drew Mal'Ganis, so
yeah,
I'm
that's
not
gonna
sure.
be rough.
Yeah, this is gonna be really tough to come back from.
Is a tough card to beat.
Actually, he has Sap, so he'll be good against Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, but then he still has to kill it, right? Again, that's the big problem. It's killing Mal'Ganis once it comes out of Bane of Doom and finishes off one of your minions.
Is it like ever something that's not Mal'Ganis? Or Blood Imp / like a one drop? I always feel like where's like Felguard and Dread
Good Lord.
Infernal?
Yeah,
and,
where
like,
are Felguard, those guys?
Felguard actually comes out against me quite a bit.
Okay, I've never seen it. Almost
Doom
never,
Guard
rather.
Too.
Yeah.
I guess but, I just like, ignore
it. I really feel like it's legendary or just bust.
So many. I mean, it's the sort of card that people remember when the huge, crazy swingy things happen and they sort of are like, oh, that's what happens all the time. It's like, that's not quite true. But
the guy got, you know, one day though, the first day I started playing Bane of Doom post patch, my first three hits were three Mal'Ganises followed by two Illidans and a Draxxus. Like those first hits were glorious, but I can't say I've had like as good luck since.
Should've been playing the lottery, Noxious.
Yeah, I don't know what I was doing that day.
Yeah,
what a waste of my time.
All right, I feel like you're in a comfortable enough spot to prep Sprint here. Even though you do generally want to fight back for the board, it's like you've seen that the deck slowed down a little bit, and you do have a Drake Backstab. How often do you get a chance to sprint against Zoo too? Like, normally they're pressuring you too much, so I'm liking it here.
And it does seem like establishing, getting to dig further into your deck. Ooh, he's going.
I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure about the sprint. Oil. It feels like, yeah.
Okay. He's oiling.
Yeah, he is. It seems.
Okay. Oil allows him to
get the... Look at his face. Look at Dice's face. Like, oh.
But well, that I'm Bane of Doom is going to be so good.
Yeah, this is going to be...
Even if it wasn't, though, cards like Implosion feels like it makes it a little bit weaker against...
What is it? What's in the box?
Oh,
my God. I'm pretty sure I told... Like, I'm not even surprised. I don't know why you guys are freaking out.
Bamford.
Your casual comment about Mal'Ganis playing it cool, like it's just another day in Hearthstone.
Is that what's going to happen next turn, which is Knife Juggler Implosion with Mal'Ganis on board.
Yeah, but it's gone. It's going to face tanked, by the way.
Oh, it's going to die. Oh.
Rest in pepperoni, Mal'Ganis. But still, 9 damage. That's quite the job. Yeah. Now, what if it hits for 4? Do we just quit Hearthstone? What would happen?
Well,
first
Mal'Ganis,
think... and now...
Yeah. Oh my god.
It's one of those games, guys. It's just one of those games.
Like, this is kind of it.
You see Tice, you know, just sort of sitting back in his chair, like, really? Is this my life right now?
Did I really start playing this a long time ago to get into situations like these?
To be fair, Tice in the previous game against, Frozen Ice had some pretty awesome outcomes too, with how things were going with the wild growths into like Dr. Booms and the way it transpired. So he's feeling the rogue pain that he dished out last game.
That's true. It all evens out at some point, but not when you're actually playing the game and feeling horrible about what's going on.
Yeah, Blizzard's out to get you when you're playing the game.
Not a single life tap was had that day, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, you're right. He hasn't actually been able to utilize a hero power. He's had zero blowback this game.
Yeah, he might get some of the flame imp, though. It's going to be dangerous.
That is true. This actually might be an opportunity to tap, too, if he wants to, like, sort of hedge against any type of, like, Fan of Knives action, but I think it should be okay just to play the flame imp here.
I mean, if you're in Silent Storm spot here, what you're mostly thinking about is, like, how do I lose this game?
Yeah, that's part of the question.
How does this game go wrong for me? And, I'm actually a little surprised that he played the flame imp for that reason. Mm-hmm. Because it does feel like, you know, what he could possibly lose to here is something like a Blade Flurry.
That would already kill it, yeah.
Yeah, so it feels like, I mean, yes, he's presenting lethal damage even if his opponent kills, you know, one of his imps this turn. You know, his opponent has to either trade away the SI or he's going to die. But it feels like you just have such an advantage, and if you're life tapping, the ability, your chances to find something like a Doomguard, Power Overwhelming that represent lethal anyway are really high.
All right, well, he's going to try to fight back with Lotheb. Man, removing those imps one by one.
Having to kill an imp with a deadly poisoned up dagger is a miserable, miserable feeling.
Oh, wow.
Oof. Well, he's got effective lethal if he can just let this...
He keep on the good job.
If he hits twice, just hits twice, it's fine.
Yeah.
Twice to the face. Here we go. One. Okay, never mind. Yes, Silent Storm's not the best Zoo player in the world.
Yeah.
But he's all right. He's pretty good.
He's okay.
Seriously, this game, like, Tice's game the win at all. All
right, well. I mean, I think you still just go face now and put your opponent at dead to the death rattle of Leprenome.
Yeah. And before Hailbot, Blade Flurry, and then you regret everything you ever did in your life.
Yeah. I suppose you could sprint just to see other cards in your deck if you're a masochist, but there's really nothing that can help him because he can't kill, right?
No.
What if he drew prep oil into prep Blade Flurry?
He's already used the prep.
He's already used an oil.
Okay.
And an oil.
And a prep.
And an oil.
Well, the oil's right there in his hand.
I meant oil, not Blade Flurry when I said that.
Okay.
Literally,
he used the prep.
I'm thinking the right one.
8, 9, 15.
So many oils and preps. 19.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, so well, we're at 3-3.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of nice to see that this entire league so far hasn't really been, like, there haven't been any, you know, 6-1s. Like, I think the closest we got, like, a 6-3 and a 3-6, one way or the other, for two teams. But that's the closest we got, and that's, like, 66% win rate, which, again, it's pretty good. It's really good, but it's not necessarily indicative of, like, a massive discrepancy, and over such a short amount of time, it'll be really maybe over the next few weeks when maybe that'll show up. But for now, it looks like every single time it's really close.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to be curious to see how things shape out. You know, things like statistics over the course of the league, class win rates, team win rates, player win rates. I think there's you know, playing best of 11s gives you a lot of data over time, and it'll be interesting to see how everything sort of pans out as the league progresses.
Yeah, that's really what I'm kind of compiling the stats that I get just to see how it goes. And very often it seems like, and you know, we've already talked about this, it's like one player gets a really bad streak of games with one deck that doesn't seem like it's doing too well against the lineup that the opponent might have when some bad luck also comes in. But very often it's not like the entire player, it's not even the player's fault, it feels sometimes. It's like the deck they've got doesn't really map to what they really needed, so they end up suffering for it.
Yeah, I mean, deck selection is a team decision. You know, you're joining together as a group, deciding what decks we're going to play and who's going to play them. Yeah. So if one player does poorly with a particular deck, you know, it's not exclusively that player's fault.
Do you guys have a shot caller in Value Town?
Shot caller.
And they have like a guy who says, "All right,
Kibber plays carry, and okay. You know, Trump's there for the support." And I'm pretty sure that dog's
mid,
their jungler.
But I'm actually usually more of a tank when I'm playing.
Playing
Bobas,
ETC Diablo. Sorry, yeah. I don't play any.
What do you mean? I was playing
some heroes right before this, and I was playing some Muradin. So.
So you play team brawlers, right? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Who says tanks?
I believe it's hero brawlers is the term.
Yeah, hero brawler is the official term.
Yes.
And if that's your first offense, the second will get you removed from the cast.
Better believe it. It's true.
What are we going with here? I'm still feeling like Hunter's a pretty good choice from Nilum. Rogue is okay too. Rogue is okay.
I think Hunter got better now that Zoo's out, actually. If it's a mid-range.
But Hunter's still pretty strong against Zoo, generally speaking.
So we've seen every deck except for Silent Storm's Paladin and RDU's Hunter at this point. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yep. Did we see the Druid from Tiddler?
Oh, no, we haven't seen Tiddler's Druid yet.
Yeah, we haven't seen his Druid yet. So that's another deck we're missing.
It is much less sort of relevant as to the specific contents of a Druid deck these days. There aren't different Druid decks.
That's right. What's in the deck? I guess two Innervates, two Elves,
Wild
Growth,
Ancient of Lores. I don't know. What would you put in a Druid deck?
Yeah, probably like Meta Addict. I'd put Nuzdorm in a Druid deck. Sue me.
Oh, I've done that.
Oh, how does it work for you?
Usually I play Nuzdormu and hope that my opponent ropes, because otherwise I'm going to lose that turn.
I know, right? It seems like whenever I play it, I'm like, I hope you're AFK and all that. Yeah,
I was streaming with my Dragon Druid deck. I'm just like, okay, our hope this game is that I innervate out Nuzdormu and my opponent went to the bathroom.
Yeah,
wait, you gotta like wait though, because if you play at a certain tempo, like you play at a certain pace, like you both play fast, then like he has to pay attention. But if you like, you know, warm it up a little bit, Kibler, where you're taking your time, thinking he'll alt tab, and then
yeah, you know, that's what I do. That you've got to play the meta outside the meta. It's conditioning. You're metaing the meta, man.
You gotta play to you know the player's tendencies and everything.
Yeah. Play face on through your rope as much as you can and lose his attention.
Right, so we finally do have Silent Storm's Paladin deck showing up here, and it is mid-range Paladin.
Okay. It's a very awkward mid-range Paladin, but he's got double 4-drop, which is great.
Mm-hmm. He actually has quadruple 4-drop. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's going to get to turn 7 with that to draw boom. He's good to go.
He actually has the classic Paladin hand, 4/4-drops.
Welcome to Arena.
Just needs Consecration.
Yeah.
And then he's got
Hammer of Wrath.
Yeah.
That's all you need, just the Hammer
Blessing
of Wrath.
Of Kings.
Yeah.
But, I mean, to be fair, True Silver is actually one of the better cards, and Pilot Shredder. All those 4-drops that he has in his hand are among the best cards against Rogue, because the True Silver champions allow you to remove the early opposing minions, so your opponent can't get a tempo advantage with saps and their removal spells. And then Piloted Shredder is difficult for the Rogue to actually keep off the board. So even though his hand is pretty glutted at the particular cost, they're among his best cards in the matchup.
Okay. Yeah. True. Rogue also can usually take its time against the Paladin.
Also really, true.
Yeah, like it's got lots of time, especially with a Zombie Chow out. What's the rush? There's no rush. You know, kick on some nice Luau music, get yourselves a nice Mojito Tice.
And when Blessing of Kings comes up, though, the panic mode enters. That's where it kind of starts. Music speeds up a little bit. And you don't take the Zombie Chow as a nice friend anymore.
It's true.
Oh, wow. Well, all right.
Oh, dear.
Oh, my God. Are you afraid of, like, the Harrison Jones?
You might be, but is that enough of a deterrent to not just... Just do it.
It's really good ways to clear the board in the next couple turns too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, Assassin's Blade is so strong here. If your opponent doesn't have Harrison immediately, you're able to use it to kill the Zombie Chow, kill the Shredder, and even potentially set up a huge Blade Flurry in a later turn. I mean, I think what Tice is really thinking about here is, you know, okay, well, what are my other plays? Because Assassin's Blade is obviously a super strong play if his opponent doesn't have Harrison, but is very dangerous if his opponent does. And I think he's wondering if he's able to set up a play that's safer, and if it's still, you know, anywhere close to as strong. He decides to go with Loth.
This is kind of setting up to where it's a bit awkward, in theory, if there's no Aldor Peacekeeper for your opponent, because he's got to use 6 damage on your Lotheb, and it might pop the Shredder if you opt to not go with your weapon. But in this case, it's not really going to be any problem for Soundstorm.
Yeah, so. I don't particularly like the Lotheb there. I mean, you know, obviously the question is really if he is willing to expose the Assassin's Blade, but but Lotheb there, like, there are so many easy ways, even just on board, for Silent Storm to be able to deal with that.
Well, he's still presented with the same awkward problem.
Dilemma, you know? Yeah. I'd go phase here. I'd play Assassin's Blade, maybe just Punch Phase instead of Auto Barber, Tinkers, or like you go for Auto Barber, Blade Flurry, or Tinkers, Blade Flurry, pick your choice. It's so awful of a position to be in, honestly.
I mean, now the Assassin's Blade, as the turns go on and there's more opposing minions in play, Assassin's Blade is also just getting worse.
Yeah,
because you're taking more damage every turn your opponent is able to.
Oh,
and he's just a wiser man than I am. Much wiser man than I am. I'm a hunter player at heart, I think.
Man, I wonder if Tice is just hoping that Silent Storm will expose his Harrison just on his dagger or something at some point. Which I wouldn't imagine is a likely thing that Silent Storm would do, because I wonder if he ever plans on playing that Assassin's Blade at this point, you know?
Well, I mean, he's picked up some pretty decent cards for now. Things will start a little weird when Dr. Boom comes up.
I know what you're saying, but at the same time, it's very difficult to make something like that call, because Tice knows that it's very common to keep Harrison Jones in your opening hand. It's something that you really always want to keep against Rogue, so you keep your options open. Assassin's Blade. Well, now he gets to finally control the board without taking too much.
Oh, wow. Okay.
All right. I mean, that's kind of
kind of a minion. It kind of kills
him. Yeah, I mean, Dr. Boom comes out here, so I guess he was hoping to maybe get that next turn, but it's fine.
So this is where you top deck your second oil, then you sap Dr. Boom, you oil Auto Barber, go face 3 times, then you win. Is that it?
Is that how it works?
Yeah, that's how I play Hearthstone.
Violence isn't the answer, Noxious, all the time. You gotta think through strategically, so that way you can skillfully hit the face and win.
Yeah, I strategically click my opponent's face.
I do.
I strategically quick shot his face.
I used my brain cells and calories in my fingers to do that.
Yeah. I wonder, we should do an experiment with this. Like, how many calories does a control warrior burn per hour or a patient warrior compared to that of a face hunter? I really am curious to know if there's a noticeable difference to where you could evaluate somebody's playstop references based on their energy expenditure. Like, that would be a worthwhile study.
I mean, given how much I constantly click around the screen no matter what I'm playing, I think it would actually really throw things off.
I concur. I do the same.
I was actually in Ireland for Magic Tournament a while ago, and had one of those Fitbit tracker things that, like, it blinked at one point during the middle of the day and was like, oh, you've reached your step goal for the day, when I had done nothing but sit around, like, playing decks, because it thought that my, like, hand shuffling was actually me working out.
Oh man, I'm not sure about that punch to the boom. I would have sapped it almost and gone face and then sprinted into another sap to restart the cycle and maybe. Then again, he's keeping sap for Tyrion, obviously, but okay. He's playing around Lay on Hands and Tyrion, so that makes a lot of sense. Never mind, I'm obviously out of my head.
I mean, it's always difficult to evaluate from the perspective of someone who has the full information here. Mm-hmm. But I mean, he is putting himself pretty low against just, you know, the opposing True Silver in play right now.
Yeah.
I mean, Palad doesn't have very much burst damage, but there's already 4 in play, and Tice doesn't really have a great way to clear the board against a lot of different things. But Soundstorm does go for just the lay on hands. It finds Harrison Jones.
Yep. And pretty much should be able to catch at least one of the durability charges here on the weapon. Mm-hmm. But he's got his own semi lay on hands. Not really, just forgetting the heal part. Don't forget that it's also lethal if Silencehorn picks up Consecration next turn.
Yeah, that's also true.
True Silver, Juggler, Muster might just do it. I'll be honest, it's guaranteed lethal with that, so he's got it.
Oh, you're right. Because of the Silence only takes one. Mm-hmm. Well met indeed. Team Celestial strikes back and goes up 4-3. It's been neck and neck. Neither team able to get a commanding lead in the series outside of the first two games by Life Coach.
Yeah, Soundstorm's still undefeated though in his 2 weeks of play with Paladin and Warlock. And last week it was with Shaman, I think, instead of the Paladin.
Yeah, Rogue is struggling a little bit here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Kind of weird, actually. I remember RDU yesterday mentioning something about the fact that a perfectly played Rogue could never lose to a Paladin. Or something along those lines. So maybe he's going to have a little talk with Thais. But I think ultimately it boils down to the early game and how it panned out with the four drops. Just really lining up perfectly.
Yeah, I mean, those Shredders were quite good for Silent Storm. And I mean, I have to really look at the turn 5 play of Lotheb versus playing the Assassin's Blade. If he did just choose to play Assassin's Blade the very next turn, like, I have to wonder what his sort of reasoning there was, given how many ways Paladin has to really neutralize that Lotheb there and extend its board more, that makes the Assassin's Blade worse and worse every turn that goes on.
Yeah. Well, we'd have to ask. I guess some information.
Well, for now, Tice is benched. He's sitting so there,
that means
ice cold.
It's only RDU who can play.
That's right. RDU
Hunter's gonna come
the
out.
Hunter and the Paladin. Up against Rogue and Druid. Yeah, I think I'm feeling the Hunter here. Hunter feels like it's pretty reasonable. It looks like the last resort strategy here for Nilum would be to take out the Druid, which seems to be the unfortunate outcome for several series so far in this tournament, that people are just ganging up on the poor Druid. But that's still an out there. But Team Celestial is also closing in. Druid and Rogue are two decks that are capable of beating anything. Really explosive decks that have lots of good draw potential if things work out well.
Yeah, it's all about getting that, the curve with the Druid. You just try to ramp up into a Shade, into a Shredder. You just hit your 3, 4, 5, and usually you can go from there and do whatever. It's a pretty tough
thing. The most important thing is
hitting
your 2, which is Wild Growth.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like the one card you have on that specific mana slot. I wonder, like, initially, I know when they released Growth Tender, that people thought, hey, this is, another cool ramp option, but it's not really, like, because it's symmetrical, it really doesn't do as much as you'd like it to. So
I think Growth Tender is good in the ramp decks against aggressive decks.
Aggressive decks
really have great tools to utilize that ramp. But the problem is, even aggressive decks have a lot of higher drops nowadays. You see a lot of the Hunter decks with their high mains. You see, Dr. Boom and Mal'Ganis in aggressive Warlock decks. Yep. So there are fewer and fewer decks. Really, Face Hunter is the only class, sort of class strategy combination that can't really make great use out of that ramp effect.
Mm-hmm.
Or they can even use it to empty their hand and quick shot you.
Into another quick shot.
Yeah.
Frozen Ice here nodding at his hand, it seems.
Yeah, he's not at that proving. Hand. Whenever you're on the coin, yep, against Hunter and you have things like SI7 Agent, you're feeling pretty good. Although I'm not sure how great Assassin's Blade is against Hunter. Most likely you would rather have other cards that help you race more efficiently, because Assassin's Blade not only takes your entire turn, but it takes multiple turns for you to get out. How often will you have 4 turns to race Hunter from that point on? Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. All right. The Leprechaun might change the way the turn was going to get played.
What trap is that? Do we know it all?
It's freezing. It can't be replayed. So.
Oh, you're right.
Okay. Yeah. So if it looks freezing, like RDU has the hybrid Hunter deck.
Yeah. The deck with like all the face Hunter cards and 4 to 5 non-Hunter cards. Yeah.
I mean, well, it pretty much is high main, right?
Mm-hmm. It's high main, Lotheb, and Shredder are the sort of higher end cards.
Yes. Yep. Well, and Freezing Trap is a little unique too, considering that you try to optimize damage per card in Face Hunter versus Freezing Trap is more of a tempo play.
Freezing Trap, it's kind of playing minions from mostly.
Reminds me of what you mentioned about recurring damage, right? When hybrid and mid-range become, you know, they start playing bulkier minions, the point is to get the recurring damage in, and that's kind of what hybrid aims to do with the Freezing Traps.
Oh yeah, exactly. You're looking to protect your minions from opposing stuff. I think the mad scientists are particularly good in Hybrid Hunter because they are able to, you know, get a Freezing Trap, which is able to protect your early minions. Which, you know, you're able to get early damage in from things like Leprechaun or whatever else very effectively, which is quite important for a lot of your matchups.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, here he's got a couple of options. One thing that you do have to consider is that you have a lot of weapon charges to be able to push out. And the flexibility about Hybrid Hunter is being able to be aggressive against decks that are slower than you, like much more aggressive, but also to slightly be defensive against also really aggressive decks too. And against Rogue, you're trying to be really aggressive. Yes. So I think I really like distributing out. I know some players might be thinking about, well, how do I set up hero powers over the next couple of turns? But there's really no smooth way to do that.
Oh, that's quite nice here for RGU.
It's a very, very...
Huffer?
The worst of them, but then again, Frozen Ice can't kill it.
Yeah. Kill the Leok?
Yeah,
well, he can if he's willing. Oh, he doesn't actually have the combo.
His hand is really expensive here.
Yeah, it's like the top end of a rogue hand.
He could use that, what's that one card?
The prep.
That adventure where like all your cards cost four less. That card I liked a lot. That was awesome.
Oh, wow.
Second Sprint? Adventure. The last card you want to see there?
Yeah.
Actually, this is a really good outcome for RDU. If he gives it, like, if Frozen Ice attacks, he gives his opponent an extra charge. If it's Snake Trap, he also risks triggering snakes by attacking into Leok. So he's probably just going to pass.
Mm-hmm.
This is where things become scary.
So you're in this interesting dilemma where you want to dump your hand so that Quick Shot can be more relevant to get its synergy, but you also want to see if you can balance the point of getting the extra charge in the bow, but then the longer you wait to attack the bow, do you actually have that many turns to get bow or weapon synergy in attacks? It's like all these questions of how much you can calculate damage over the next couple turns.
I kind of like popping the shredder, but...
You said popping the shredder?
Yeah, because if you actually empty your entire hand, you can play Glyvzuka to buff...
Missed face, man. Missed face.
So you just replay the weapon full face with everything. All right,
face is the only real thing you have to attack here, because you have a lot of weapon charges and you have Quick Shot.
Yeah, I mean, you have your Glyvzuka here. Like, I don't think you can afford to try and play a long game against an opponent who has so many cards in their hand.
So you're forcing Freezing Trap to be like less efficient than you'd like it to be, but it's still going to work out.
Well, I mean, like, if you pop that, you can maybe use Quick Shot to get rid of it.
Yeah,
but
you're right.
You're using so much of your damage on your opposing minion.
Mm. Yes. And what you're also
getting to a point where they can very easily use removal to kill your guys, so you're not necessarily protecting them.
Yep. That's what I get for playing Priest.
100%. Well, now a preparation does open up some options here for Frozen Ice. The question becomes, though, it's beyond just stabilization point. It's, can you convert things like your hand into a win? You know, what are some of the key cards that you need to pick up here? I think he needs to pick up some heal eventually. He's going to use his Eviscerate to try to stabilize, but he's going to be looking for his heal bots, his Farseers.
The second prep was actually a pretty nice pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Being able to potentially enable bigger plays in these next few turns.
He's gonna lose a card. Oh no. What if it's the heal bot?
Yeah, but he needed to do damage. Losing the heal bot would have really been travesty.
Oh god.
Oh my goodness.
That is a gross draw.
Okay, into a second Quick Shot, and we're lethal.
Oh, that's close enough.
Close.
So you just probably play
there's
it
no
because
reason,
you can.
There's no reason to play it here, because you can just hero power, I think.
Yeah.
Well, I guess you want it. No.
You play it, I think, just because you can.
Well, what does playing it entail? Like, if you play it, you're losing that possible damage if you draw another charge minion next turn. Because if he draws a Wolf Rider next turn or another Arcane Golem next turn, he wants to have Abusive Sergeant to go with that because it represents more damage.
Okay, yes. I was thinking like it would still be played on the creeper and then he punches face, and I mean ultimately it's all about the heal bot. He still has to get a heal bot no matter what, and then also wipe your board.
Oh yeah, I mean,
and there's like zero difference almost.
I think it's time for a Vitality Totem to show up, guys.
Yeah, that Shredder is gonna have to be MVP.
Time to do it. Vitality Totem.
You can still sprint into that heal bot, right? It's still doable. Like, it's not over. But, well, I mean...
The funny thing is, Vitality Totem doesn't even actually save him.
Yeah.
Because there's still damage in the hand. You can't get rid of this Haunted Creeper without sap. And it's like you said, it's like what Kibler said, the Abusive Sergeant gives him more options for chargers or minions that stick. Also, it complicates things because Frozen's like, well, he has one card in hand. What can it be?
He still can't. I lied, actually. He's still off mana for the heal bot. So he'd have to find a way to draw. Did he play Farseer, maybe? Yeah, that's like the one card that might do it.
Alright, Hunter does it. Pressures the rogue out of the game.
Yeah, RD with his win must be feeling pretty happy about that.
Tied back up 4-4.
And. Also, an interesting trend is that Tice and Frozen Ice both have lost 3 games so far today, and it seems specifically like the Rogues are struggling. Both these guys are not able to get the wins with the Rogues. Tice did end up losing with Druid, but you know the point is being that it seems like Rogue not being able to exit out early and might come down to who can get the Rogue wins.
Well, there's a Druid left on Celestial side, right? So that's already something that's a bit maybe more difficult to pull off. You know, we've seen Druid struggle a little bit recently, so maybe Tiller is going to be the crucible for the entire Celestial team. Because against Paladin, Druid, it's like a toss. I guess it's like a coin toss very often. So yeah, RD could get it.
I'm anticipating Rogue coming out once again for Frozen Ice. So that way he can try and get the win before like anything else. It's going to disincentivize Tice from from switching out to Paladin here. And it might be Rogue versus Rogue here.
Yeah, I think that's the most sensible approach, like to Nash it.
Myth, I think the worst matchup here is the Paladin versus Rogue. That's the matchup that RDU really wants to dodge. Mm-hmm. So... You know, this is really where it comes down to, you know, okay, well, our Rogue is best against both the opposing decks, but, you know, we kind of don't want our Rogue to beat the opposing Druid and our Paladin to have no good matchups left. I think that's like one thing that you might want to, you know, need to be thinking about here, is your Paladin needs to find a win. Whether it finds a win, you know, this round or next round isn't necessarily relevant, but if it has such a worse matchup against the Rogue, it's possible that you want to play your Rogue first, so... You don't have the possibility of your opponent's Druid being eliminated by beating your Rogue.
Yeah, that's true. Then you
There's also some weird layers of these things. Sometimes it's just let's roll a dice so they can't outthink us.
Yeah, and again, the tech cards matter a lot. Like I haven't really seen the entire deck list. We'll be getting them published, I think, soon after this. It's just that those can really matter when it comes to playing the matches, because if you have, say, like Harrison Jones versus Rogue won't change a thing, but if, say, the Druid from Tiddler has specific techs that enable him to do better against one or the other class, say Mind Control tech against the Paladin, then that's going to be something he might be okay with. Even though the Rogue has such a good matchup, he might still feel comfortable. So it's going to be a mirror match, so they're going to Nash it and just go Rogue versus Rogue with a coin flip.
So we didn't really see any particularly unusual cards in either of these decks, if I recall correctly. I know that yesterday Oskaka had a Harrison Jones in his Rogue deck, and I believe Dog played Double Healbot in his. So those are the sort of things that I think are important to note when you're trying to scout for your team. Okay, well, what are the things that players have that we need to really keep an eye on? Is knowing your opponent has one healbot versus two healbots or no healbots can really fundamentally change the way that you want to approach a game.
Yeah, I think so too. But in this matchup specifically, the Rogue versus the Rogue, it's not dictated about the heal bots. It really often is dictated upon who can grab the board and maintain tempo. Even sometimes card advantage won't really matter as much if you can just press in for the win. Rogue can't stabilize enough. Also, I think if either of them have Lotheb, that could be the really big MVP card, considering that Rogue is really dependent upon so much spells. It's probably like one of the highest density of spells out of almost any deck outside of like deck like Freeze Mage, for example.
I mean, I think Lotheb was originally basically printed to deal with Rogue combo decks when they were out of control with Miracle.
Yeah,
that was a bit. Actually, it's kind of funny because when they made Lotheb and then nerfed Gadgetzan, it was like a double pronged nerf to the deck. And then for a long time, people thought, hey, we'll never see this archetype ever come back. Which, you know, the archetype hasn't come back, but we found another way to play an aggro control, you know, Rogue deck. I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, and even to be fair, the last iteration of Miracle wasn't truly a Miracle.
It was more
either.
Tempo, yeah.
Yeah, it was more like just like a combo deck, you know, and that's kind of what it was, because before in the past it was truly Miracle, or you'd need to rely on everything with like Leroy because you played Acolytes, not Farseers, and
yeah, cards. You just drew as much as you could, and then it became more of a, I play Violet Teachers, and I play Farseers, and I play all sorts of little tempo cards to give me the edge.
And that's why so many people called for preparation to be chopped on the block, right?
Because
preparation was enabling all these amazing tempo plays and card draw at the same time with Gadgetzan Auctioneer. And then, you know, people eventually realize like, okay, well, card draw really generates a lot of that fuel, so that way it's relevant.
Yeah. And Sprint wasn't played, so it's good to see that at least we got a new card engine that was around but never saw any play. All right, back to the game, though. The Azure Drake backstab attack was pretty cool, and I think the same might happen on the other side.
I didn't see exactly the same thing come out. The true mirror match.
Yeah.
Yeah, one person did get to sprint, though, and the other one didn't. And that might start favoring Frozen Ice if he can start commandingly grab tempo. In a match where you're almost going move for move, the person going first is just at, like, such a huge advantage. Like, this is where, like, a lot of people who initially start playing Hearthstone are like, wow, the coin's amazing! You can get an extra card, and you can, like, get ahead on one turn, and it's true, but what if you get the coin every turn? It's like, this is kind of the example where you're going ahead of your opponent. At best, they can just respond.
Well, they get one turn because of the coin. They do something before you do.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you're able to snowball that advantage that you gain from that, it's one thing. But if your opponent is able to, you know, just react to what you do with the same basic play, which is exactly what we saw here, was the player who coined got a very strong tempo play that took out their Drake, opening there.
I mean, the Selfie deckhand is a pretty important card in this matchup because it'll enable that turn where you really want to get the burst going. I think it's one of the most... it's a card that some people ended up cutting from their Oil Rogue decks at some point, but it came back full swing. Like, once people realize, hey, it's kind of cool to have that one turn kill option. It's like if patrons cut Frothings to play, I don't know, the eggs, you know, the one mana whelp eggs. Or Nerubian Eggs, you're like, okay, I mean, sure, it's kind of cute, but ultimately, I still want the opportunity to one-shot you.
I mean, it adds a totally different dimension to what the deck is capable of doing and forces your opponent to play around it. And if your opponent knows that you don't have it, they can make very, very different plays than if they even fear you do. And this is, we're seeing right here, one of the reasons that the Shredder is so strong from any deck against Rogue. Here it is in the Rogue Mirror, where it's like, okay, well, I don't really have any clean way to ensure that I'm getting this off the board.
Can you race at all, do you think?
I was going to say, if he plays Eviscerate on the Shredder, he's thinking to himself, well, I need to prep Sprint to catch up if I do that, because then my damage output will be way too low to really pressure. And that would be done with Antique Healbot. So it's either he's gonna play, you know, slower game and give his opponent the opportunity to respond again, or he's just gonna push for the damage and race, which I think might be just the correct approach.
I like that. I mean, he has so much damage in hand with the Southsea double eviscerate and the oil. But uh-oh, here is Lotheb, which makes the racing situation... The math changes a little bit.
Yeah, it changes significantly, considering that he can load the board and push from this point on. It's really scary.
Yeah, there's no Tinkers, but he doesn't need it, and he's got the heal bot in case Thais goes all in. But the Blade Flurry is still, you know, a pretty good card for Thais. He's just going to be taking a ton of damage before he can really do anything with it.
Oh, man.
Yeah, that hurts.
Hold on.
Oh?
I think he if he equips his deadly poison, his opponent can't kill him. Oh, he's heal bot. Never mind.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I was thinking, like, if he equipped deadly poison here and then went for the full combo next turn, I think he could just kill his opponent straight up.
Well, let's assume from 26. Like, what have you got? You got...
Well, he's going to have 12 damage from the Deadly Poison and the Blade Flurry on the oil, and then he'll have 5 from the deckhand. So that's 17 plus an Eviscerate would be 21. He can't fit in the second Eviscerate.
Yeah, that's the problem. He's a tiny bit of mana short. Like, if he picks up a prep next turn, that'd be like...
Right. But that's assuming he equips like Deadly Poison.
Yeah, and right. And
Frozen Ice like doesn't play heal by. He plays second sprint because he's greedy.
Yeah. That's a big assumption. I mean, you still have to set up the dagger, though, because you know you're going to have to Blade Flurry anyway. So you still are forced to play this dagger.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But
oh, man.
If Frozen Ice auto-calls the sprint, which I can't imagine he wants to, considering that he understands that his opponent is holding a lot of spells right now and like chose to equip Deadly Poison, it's almost
also
a tell.
Big tell. Well, Thais also didn't attack a minion. You know, like if Thais was to play a slower game, you know, like he potentially would attack a minion here, and Frozen Ice has to be afraid of, okay, well, what are the implications of that?
Yes, exactly. Very good point. So with that in mind, even though Frozen Ice won't be mana efficient, dropping the heal bot. Oh my goodness.
Thais is relieved here.
Wow, and yeah.
This is Thais just staring at a win that he thought he wasn't going to get. He just literally grabbed his head and rubbed his hands all over his face. Like, this is redemption. You know, Frozen Ice is going to... I'm surprised Frozen Ice did this, knowing that if there was a Shredder or even a Lotheb in Thais' hand, it would have come down last turn.
Yeah, I mean, he knew that his hand is literally just all spells, basically.
Yeah, so. It's...
His opponent needs to have precisely these four cards for exact mana. This to happen exactly.
Yeah, you're right.
So you can't blame Frozen Ice. I don't think anything out of the Shredder can come.
He could even just have Eviscerate, not Blade Flurry here.
Yeah, it doesn't need Blade Flurry really at this point. But
true.
Yeah,
that's actually a good point as well.
Same thing. So the combinations open up a little bit, or the permutations, I guess, if you want to look at it that way. The game that Thais got here was not one that most of the time maybe he feels like he would have gotten. Like, if you're shown Frozen Ice's hand as Thais, you think to yourself, there's no way I'm not playing this this heal bot, but...
Okay.
Man, well played.
That was, I mean, that was definitely... Thais saw his way to win the game, which was to try to set up, you know, lethal on the following turn if his opponent couldn't heal. And Frozen Ice didn't respect that. He didn't play around it, and Thais ended up pulling it out.
All right, so that gives Nylum the best chance to win here from their point of view. The Paladin gets two chances. I imagine Frozen Ice would have to... Oh, wait, is he benched, actually?
Did he lose with his Rogue last time?
Yeah, he lost Rogue against Hunter from RDU.
Yeah, so actually he's benched now. So Tiddler's forced to bring out Druid, isn't he? And Paladin versus Druid is pretty much the matchup RDU wanted to get, as opposed to getting the Rogue.
Well, at this point he has to play against both of them. So
I believe
game score counts for tiebreakers eventually. So it is good that he's getting a better matchup immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as winning this actual match, he needs to take down both the Druid and the Rogue. So.
Does he?
Or rather, no, sorry. I had that messed up the other way. I was thinking the other way.
It's all right. It's all right, Kibler. We'll get to it. So basically, Paladin wins against either of these would secure the match. But because Frozen Ice is actually banished, then the Druid has to come out from Diddler. And I don't know if that's what he wants to see.
Yeah, I don't know if that's what he wants to see either, but they have to do this eventually. The score does matter, though, so... if they could pick the order that they would send the decks out, it most likely would be Rogue first, then the Druid. So that way they can optimize the score to be 6-5 if it's not in their favor, and they have their tiebreaker score as high as possible. So this is where the bench will once again be influential. And you never know, because as we mentioned at the very beginning of the show, and for anybody who is unfamiliar with the league, the tiebreaking score will determine placings, which ultimately set for the playoffs, because this is a league for $250,000. It's a lot on the line.
I mean, in some leagues where, you know, the game score might not necessarily matter, or players are playing for a bit less, they might be like, oh, well, I'm just going to play, you know, whatever, just try and get it over with. I have to win with both anyway, from the perspective of Team Celestial. But here, you know, you definitely want to maximize your chances of getting every tiebreaker point you can.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, the rules will kind of prevent that from happening. Well, with the bench, so RDU might, I mean, he might be feeling a bit more confident, you know, after that Hunter win that he picked up. And knowing that this is the match, like, RDU is the reason that this match is going to be sealed. So, pressure, RDU.
He's not exactly doing the worst here. Tice ended up having some struggles with losing a few games, but he got through it. And RDU's only been 1-1 today. Mm-hmm. So you can't really just like peg whether or not he's the win or loss reason. He'd be splitting the games with Tice if he drops two in a row here. Frozen Ice, on the other hand, he's been struggling. Tiddler, as the team captain, needs to pony up and get an important win. Wild Growth is an excellent start for it, and he still has an Innervate to back it up.
That's a pretty sick start. If I'm a Druid, I'm happy to see this. There's no possible True Server champion on the coin or anything like that. Oh, all right.
That's great. Minibot is so hard to deal with. So annoying.
Yeah. To the point of anger.
I wonder if we'll see more interactions with stuff with Divine Shield. It's not that, you know, I believe what the card leak was showing over in the Chinese forums, but it still was very interesting idea of, like, you know, whenever you do this, it, like, gains Divine Shield, and, like, being able to have really efficient board control-centric trades. It's still an underappreciated mechanic in the game, I think. Divine Shield is so powerful sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
And they really did make, like, a really good card to counter it, like, in the base pool of cards that we have. So, well, not the base, rather,
Knight?
But like
outside
the
of
epic.
Blood Knight?
Yeah. Oh my god, RDU, what is that?
Oh! True Silver.
Yes.
I was gonna say, RDU is gonna have a hard time coming back from this game if he doesn't pick up a Shredder or a True Silver, but that's kind of taken care of. That's a relief.
It's monumental, because any fire drop that comes out, he's gonna be able to answer and play his own.
Yeah.
This is kind of a weird spot, whether, because Tiddler can use his Keeper to kill the 2-2. He could also just play the Shade and Hero Power and attack the 2-2, which would let him play potentially the Keeper the following turn on maybe a Sludge Belcher, for instance, which is what we might see.
I'd be afraid of Kings, though, but...
That's true. But the longer that you wait with a Shade in your hand, the worse it gets as well.
Yeah, that's actually a really important distinction, considering that it increases the chance for things like Consecration to be drawn and Shade to be less impactful.
Oh,
I'd like
point,
to see...
3 point.
Yeah, and on the flip side, I think that also applies to RDU. How long do you want to hold on to cards like Harrison if you want to play it out and it challenges the 5 attack onto the Emperor Thorsten on turn 6? I think that might be more preferable compared to a Sludge Belcher, which could get easily bullied by something that has 5 attack or more.
Yeah, I like playing the Harrison here.
You're not trying to set up any defensive line anyway, which you might have to do once you think maybe there's going to be some kind of... Actually, you haven't seen a swipe yet, so RDU's just going to go all in and hope the Quartermaster...
This is interesting, because he does have the Quartermaster in his hand, and you know he hasn't seen swipe. His opponent, you know, could quite easily have it this turn, but he's just setting up to get a really powerful turn next.
Yeah.
It's going to go very well for him.
Expecting the Harrison Jones, but now that I think of it, if Emperor's Blade, those 1-1s contested even better, because then you're left with a 2-5 and 2-3-3s. Assuming you get the Quartermaster off and he swipes, then you can still go, you know, resume the whole Harrison Jones play that you might have been able to do.
Yeah, definitely true. I mean, the thing, as far as, you know, sort of being a little more conservative from the Druid side, if you do, because of the way that his turns, like, line up, I think that you could possibly play Harrison then play Sludge Belcher, then play Boom, then guaranteed play the Quartermaster and get value out of it, which is why, you know, I think that that's the more conservative play, but this line, you know, certainly is working out from here.
Yeah, so it was basically curving out, like, as turn 5, 6, and 7, and 8 mapped out. Oh. Do you just Sludge Belcher to frustrate your opponent?
Yeah, I think originally he was preparing the way for Dr. Boom, but now that he still has an alternative turn 7 with Sludge Belcher and Silence, he can. He also can just press for the win with Dr. Boom and let his Boom Bots plus Consecration carry him the victory, because it seems very clear that your opponent can't deal with it. I think Paladin just sees the tempo so commandingly that it almost doesn't matter, because this is the exact position that Druids hate to face against Paladin. It's happened once earlier today with Strifecrow against Druid, where all he does is continue to push with mid-sized minions, and Druid takes too much damage.
So decision here to play around Swipe a little bit, really denying the ability for Tiddler to wipe the board, even if he picks up what he wants.
We actually see a really big deal as far as the decision that RDU made in his turn of that BGH pickup. Yeah, the Dr. Boom would have been a much less significant threat here if it, you know, died right away.
I think Dr. Boom is still pretty good here. Excellent. Well,
and I'm not saying last turn.
Yeah.
Still here, but I'm saying last turn.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
Right. If it had just died to BGH and hadn't actually developed anything else, it would have been.
This is beautiful. Look at this. On the left, you've got Dr. Boom and his cronies. On the right, you've got the Quartermaster and his cronies. And in the middle, the slime just kind of not knowing what the hell he's doing.
The offering of peace from both sides. It is the peace treaty.
Okay. This is a team event and a team game. We've got, you know, the team on the left. Dr. Boom,
that's right. I think it's a symbolic version of how the rap battle should look at. You know, they have Dr. Boom's got him and his Boombot crew, and you got the Silverhand recruits and their posse together. It's a good clash face off. Yeah. The loser of this battle is the Druid, because he just has to sit here.
Yeah. He's just not involved at all, and he's still the loser.
No, he's done for. He's toast. Is there any feasible way, really? Because these Boombots can do so much, and Consecration exists too.
Yeah, you haven't seen them, so you think there's a slight chance that you're not going to take two extra damage, but deep down, somewhere deep down in your heart, you know it's over.
That's it, the game's over, and Nalum takes game 10. We're on, I was going to say like game 9 or something, but...
No, that's it. That's it.
For the match.
That's right.
Game set match. Well,
all right.
Celestial drops 0-2 in the standings. Nihilum, they were able to get the win last week, so they are also 2-0. So we have a few teams that are splitting their victories, but we also have a few teams that really need to pick up the pace. Interesting thing to note, again, Frozen Knights was the one getting bullied this series. He brought Hunter and Rogue and was only get one win and lost 4 times, unfortunately.
Yeah.
The overall standings, Nihilum will be updated to be 2-0. They joined the Forsen Boys as the only two teams to currently be undefeated overall. Team Celestial and Temple Storm are also the two teams without a win, and we have a bunch of split there. But look, Valley Town and Team Archon just tied up there in third place. Yeah, and then Cloud9 gets a really important win today as well.
Yeah. Well, those are kind of good standings going forward. I mean, it's a good start. It's giving players... I mean, this is the beginning, of course. So the teams that are they're feeling like they're not doing as well as maybe they'd like to still have time to catch up. I mean, it's not over yet. It's a bit rough. You know, 2 first weeks, if only for the morale, right? Like, the morale factor is pretty tough to keep up. Like, keep your chin up after 2 weeks of consecutive losses might feel a little disheartening.
I mean, yeah, it is. It's important to recognize that this is a long league. You know, there are quite a few weeks, and you know, we're only 2 weeks in. So while, you know, the teams that may be 0-2 now, if they're able to turn things around and pick up, you know, wins through the rest of the weeks, they can definitely keep themselves in position to make the playoffs.
Oh yeah, yep. definitely.
There's only one team, I believe, that's strictly eliminated after this first sort of round of league play. So there's a lot of chance for redemption for anyone.
Yeah, absolutely. And we can go ahead and explain that one more time. Maybe you saw your favorite team lose. Maybe you saw some of your favorite players struggling. But in the overall standings, the team that is in eighth place will be eliminated, but teams 6 and 7 get to play for a playoff spot. And then the playoff spot determines the next two teams to join the two best teams for a total of 4, and we're going to have them all in the offline event. Yeah, thank you so much for everybody who tuned in to watch today. Thank you so much to Brian Kibler and being able to join us casting along with Gara as a guest player caster. Did you enjoy it?
Oh yeah, I definitely had a lot of fun. You know, cool to see a lot of good games, a lot of really, you know, really cool stuff, both good and bad. We saw some ropes taking some players down early on, and also some really excellent play.
Yeah, all the ropes today, all the ropes.
Well, that's great. Nox, any closing thoughts for week number 2 here? We've had a lot of games so far, but I'm glad you're able to join us.
Yeah, closing thoughts? No, not so much. I mean, I'm still happy that I'm going to be hopefully coming back to cast maybe some more in the next few weeks. And I really hope we get to witness funky decks arising as a result of, you know, having so much space for people to experiment with. Since there's so many weeks, maybe people will be willing to bring something unexpected, maybe see a bit of a twist on Druid decks, because they're starting to feel a bit stale, but we'll see.
I'll see what I can do for you.
All right.
Do it.
Dragon Druid confirmed for next week. Speaking of which, guys, make sure to tune in next week. We start once again on Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific here on Amaz's channel. We want to give also a shout-out to some of the people that make this possible. Alpha Draft is giving you an opportunity to do Fantasy Hearthstone based off of the ATLC performance. So just go to alphadraft.com. They have a lot of money in prize, over 300 grand. So you can check that out, again, at alphadraft.com. Also, if you're curious about deck lists, Archon will post it on their team website. If you want to check out everything about the league as a whole, you can go to teamarchon.com/league. And with that, week 2 has concluded, but we're just getting to the good part. Thank you so much, everybody, who watched this week. We'll see you guys next time for more Archon Team League Championships. Have a good night.
Goodbye.